Heavenly Father, today we put on the full armor to protect us against attack. We put on the belt of truth to protect against lies and deception. We put on the breastplate of righteousness to protect our hearts from the temptations. We put the gospel of peace on our feet to walk in your light, peace, and freedom with the Holy Spirit. We rebuke anxious thoughts. We take up your shield of faith for protection to block and destroy all the darts and threats thrown at us by the enemy. We put on the helmet of salvation to cover our minds and thoughts, reminding us that we are children of a mighty King. We are forgiven, set free, saved by the blood of Jesus. We take up the sword of the Spirit, your living word, that has the power to demolish strongholds and is sharper than any double-edged sword. We come to you, Lord, in prayer daily. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
What's up, you guys? Welcome to The Imagination. I'm your host, Emma, and this week you are going to meet someone who immediately caught my attention when she reached out, and after I got to know her, she also captured my heart. Introducing mind control, ritual abuse, and human trafficking survivor, warrior, mother, wife, artist, creative gallery owner, muralist, tattoo studio owner, a literal walking miracle, and my dear friend, Carrie Olaje. I met Carrie through a private message, and my jaw dropped immediately on the floor after I read her words. No matter how long I've been doing these podcasts, I'm still constantly in shock and awe in learning about the things other people have experienced, and Carrie's story was no exception. Born into a multi-generational incest-based family, Carrie's abuse started from birth and was perpetuated by family and close family friends. As she began remembering and recalling her memories as an adult, she realized her life was not what she thought it was and began putting the pieces together of a story that is both equally as horrific as it is inspiring. Because despite all the time, effort, and money kept to keep Carrie locked up in a life of control and obedience, her abusers never anticipated that she would not only awaken to her abuse, but that she would put a stop to it and that it would end with her. Carrie now has a son of her own who is a big part of the why behind her decision to speak out, and one day he will grow up to realize his amazing mother is a real-life hero. This is how we change the world, one circuit breaker at a time. One of the things I love most about Carrie, besides her infectious personality, is her ability to break down hard ideas in ways that are as creative as she is. On today's show, you will get to experience some incredible visuals drawn by Carrie to help express parts of her life that are hard to put into words. I love when guests add visuals to the podcast, and if you are listening from iTunes or Spotify, feel free to open up YouTube or BitChute as well to view the art we will be discussing periodically on the show. Carrie will be going into details of her abuse on this episode, so I'm going to add a trigger warning just in case anyone is sensitive to hearing or seeing graphic details. I'm so excited for you to meet and learn from Carrie, and I'm so honored she is here with us this week. And just a reminder that if you're a survivor or a whistleblower who wants to share your information or story on this podcast, or if you just want to get a hold of me, you can now email me at imagineabetterworld2020@gmail.com. Please send me a briefing on who you are and what you'd like to present. And all my social media links are also in the show notes, and you guys are free to connect with me just in case I'm censored on any of these platforms. My donation links are also in the show notes if you'd like to contribute any donations that go towards helping the funds needed to run this podcast also. So you guys, without further ado, please help me in welcoming this week's guest, voice for the voiceless, fierce mama bear, walking miracle, anti-child abuse advocate, creative and artist, overcomer and survivor, the one, the only, Carrie Olaje. Carrie, thank you so much for being here with me today.
Thank you so much, Emma. I am like blushing. what an intro, you know. It's hard not to feel empowered after, you know, hearing your life put that way. So thank you.
I know I feel like these stories are so horrible, and survivors don't grow up in environments where you're told the strengths that you have, like all your strengths are exploited. And so I think hearing your strengths in a positive way is such a beautiful thing to be able to present, you know, and it's like, those are the things that you should have been hearing all along, and the things that hopefully you'll be hearing, you know, your whole life on from everybody that meets you. So it's an honor to have you here. Your story impacted me so much, and I know it's going to impact everybody that's listening. And your story is so multidimensional. It's a little bit different than a lot of the women that I've had on my show, and I know that you'll be breaking that down. But I'm going to turn it over to you And I'm thinking maybe we go back to the beginning and just as best as we can, you know, work through the information of what we call your crazy life and, you know, get towards the present in a sense. So do some sort of chronological and, you know, we'll just go back to the beginning and talk a little bit about your origins and your family origins.
Sounds great. Thanks so much. Well, I think one thing that you just said really hit it on the head, you know, is essentially you said our strengths are exploited, you know, and I think that's something that pretty much anyone who's a survivor of, you know, of trafficking, you know, in sexual abuse, you know, like in general will definitely feel. And it's something I feel like was the biggest reason I really stuck with my healing in the beginning, you know, like a lot of survivors, you know, experience overwhelm when you're dealing with flashbacks and all the answers to the PTSD symptoms you've experienced your whole life, essentially, you know, like start coming in usually, you know, for me it's late 20s, you know, for other people, it's a little bit earlier, other people later. You know, but I mean, it's stuff that you've been avoiding your whole life, you know, so it's something that you really like, and you've been brought up, like you said, in an environment where your strengths are exploited. So for me, I was at the point where I couldn't understand that, like, I was doing a lot of the things that you said, you know, so very like, you know, publicly, things that get me a lot of attention, you know, in the public, you know, big art projects, you know, big tattoo clientele, like all that fun stuff, you know, and it, to me, it felt empty and no one could understand like why, you know, and my therapist, you know, too, I couldn't understand why it was that a compliment for me didn't mean, oh, someone's like appreciating something I did and something I am. It meant for me, what does this person want to get from me, essentially? So that's one thing I think is the biggest benefit of healing, you know, is that I finally feel like all of my strengths are my own, you know, and that I'm not, you know, working against myself anymore. And that essentially a lot of the things I used to hate myself about, because the things that get you targeted for programs like this, you know, when it comes to not just the trafficking, you know, but when it comes to more like MK Ultra style programs and everything, you know, it's always because of your strengths, you know, that essentially get you chosen for more abuse, you know. so it's a part of why I'm here, you know, is it's taking your power back, you know, like finally, you know, to just share all the things you were never supposed to, you know, and really talk about what it is to survive the things you're not supposed to, you know?
Yes. And those are lessons that are so invaluable just in general to learn, because you can, let's just say you wanted to start a business, right? I feel like that gets so much attention in the world as being hard, and people who start a business get so much, you know, notoriety in society, and they get platforms, and they're the people, you know, everybody's fawning over. And it's like, but wait, like, they chose to do that, first of all. And second of all, you know, there's templates to follow, like business isn't something new, right? But like, I think anybody could find a formula, and like, if they stuck to it and, you know, follow the footsteps of other people, they could be successful too, right? But we're not taught how to deal with an obstacle that comes in the way of where we're going, you know, and that's inevitable no matter what we're doing, whether it is something like starting a business or just living life as a human, you know. And so we can study all we want, like how to get from here to there and follow all these people, you know, but it's like our success is going to depend upon how we deal with the roadblocks and the obstacles and the snowballs that are shooting our way that we got to push back up the hill, right? And that's what I think survivors really bring to the table, is you guys help us navigate the world that we live in, because it is unpredictable. It is traumatizing. It is full of all these abuses being thrown at us, whether invisible or things that we can see with our own eyes, whether it's generational, you know, and we're not taught that. There's not many people out there, you know, taking a stand and helping society understand how trauma affects us, how to get through it, and how to be able to navigate the uncertainty of life, you know, not the things that we can memorize and recite and take a test for, but like real life stuff, you know, and you all do it with such a place of love. You know, you've discovered so much emotionally from breaking down all those layers. And I think you in particular, like you're very eloquent with helping explain those different layers, you know, and the emotional part of it and the physical part of it and like just the how they intermingle with each other. And I'm excited for people to get to learn those different lessons from you.
Thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate it. You know, to me, like I've had a lot of, you know, people, therapists, you know, are different, be like, you know, you've healed so fast, you know, or I've been in AA for like 11 years, you got sober so quickly, you know, and everything. And I was like, I feel like everything I've done, I've been forced into, you know, because the alternative was like, you know, nothing essentially, you know. So it's like, for me, it's like the healing, everything, you know, the amount of time and work, you know, that goes into like, you know, exploring like the toughest topics and subjects, you know, and experiences you never wanted to think about ever again, you know what I mean? Like it's all worth it, you know? And that's really like why, you know, multiple reasons, I'll just quickly go over that, you know, multiple reasons that I'm here today, you know, is one, to help inspire survivors, like many of the survivors on your show have inspired me, you know, but in addition to that, it's, you know, once you come to a point in your healing where, you know, the anger gets bigger than the fear, essentially, to me, I just couldn't really like sleep with myself anymore, like knowing, essentially just knowing like how big the trafficking problem was and knowing how big that industry was when I was a kid and knowing that nothing had really changed, you know, and just like the number of victims that I personally saw that had it, you know, as bad as we're going to go into what I went through, you know, that had it worse than me because, you know, they didn't make it out alive, you know, or they disappeared into a black hole, you know? And that's the thing that really pisses me off at this point, is just knowing that like the only ones that know these, you know, these children's, these animals, these, you know, like all these victims' experiences, the only ones that know them are the abusers and the perpetrators, you know, and those people think about it and they get off on it. They don't honor their memory at all, you know? And that's the thing for me that I, you know, is just knowing that I'm at a place where I've been healing, you know, for 7 years with trauma therapy, you know, and I feel very lucky and very grateful to have such like a successful, you know, life, you know, from a professional and like, you know, a home standpoint, you know, I have beautiful family. Like, it's just really like, I mean, more than I could have ever dreamed about, you know, but it's just in my gut, you know, just like, I can't stand the fact knowing that there are still kids in that situation, you know, and that they're going to be years until they'll be out of it, you know, and even have the chance to heal, you know? So for me, it at a certain point, it's very difficult to do this for sure. Like like you mentioned, we're going to be talking about the most disgusting, humiliating, like evil acts that human beings can perpetrate on each other, you know, when it comes down to it, like the worst shit. But it really, like I said, can't compare to like, you know, someone still going through that, you know, or, you know, like I said, people that had it worse off than I did, you know. And that's why, you know, really, that's why we're here, is because I feel, you know, I feel the need to add my voice to all the ones that you've had that have both helped me, empower me to heal and speak out about the experiences I went through, but then also to, you know, eventually the weight of our voices, you know, is going to create some sort of change, you know, and eventually it's going to happen. And I have a hunch sooner versus later, you know, so, yeah, I mean,
beautiful.
Yes, I'm gonna grab a quick drink, and then, you know, if you have any questions, and then I'll just kind of get right into it. I'll kind of just get into like my history, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. I just wanted to say that I'm noticing more people are reaching out to me, and I know I've been around a little bit longer. I don't have a big platform, but you know, I was beating on people's doors in the beginning, and now I have people, you know, in my email and all my inboxes on all different social media. And it's like, it is amazing just seeing, you know, torch bearers coming forth with a torch and people behind them in the darkness, seeing it in the distance and, you know, coming up and grabbing it from them. And it's like, you saw the light in your darkness and, you know, found people that helped put your story together and found things that motivated you as, you know, as a survivor and as a mother and an overcomer. And now you get to pass that torch on to everybody listening to you. And I think that's such a beautiful full circle that you're completing here.
Thank you. So now we're about to go to the dark stuff. It's always such, a big leap to make, you know, when we go from like, you know, like focusing on the positive, the healing and all that stuff to why, you know, what got us here to begin with, you know? Yes. So, you know, when it comes to the abuse and everything, I kind of have to start essentially before my birth and just kind of really explain who my parents were. So, you know, both my mother and father ended up joining the military very young, you know, I think one was 18 and one was 17, you know, like coming from very small towns. My father was is a Mexican American immigrant. And then my mother was like a rural Indiana. They essentially joined the military, you know, to get out of their circumstances or whatever. But my dad essentially has always had a history of being a psychopath. We can mince terms here. You know, we have psychopaths, we have sociopaths, and we have malignant narcissists. You know, when it comes down to it, you know, the psychopaths and the sociopaths are going to be the ones that are perpetrating, you know, really horrible crimes, and are not going to have any empathy that prevents them from holding back from that. You know, they are going to take advantage of any situation they can. And the unfortunate thing is that my dad kind of like, you know, a lot of people with antisocial personality disorder was, you know, what they consider like a complex one versus a simple one. You know, a simple one ends up in jail after a few crimes. Complex, you know, they're like, you know, your Gacy's and everyone who, you know, everyone's like, they were a pillar of the community, you know, so charming, so funny, so intelligent, yada, 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 you know, so all that stuff, you know, that was my dad, you know, and he found in my mom essentially, you know, the perfect victim, you know, someone else who had also been abused generationally, you know, and was, you know, essentially like ready to be manipulated by a psychopath. So the story, you know, for me, like, you know, that kind of really sets it up, you know, for, you know, kind of letting people know that that is one thing, like we had mentioned, there are some things that I am grateful, you know, for that I'm a little bit different with than other survivors, is that I do have a very loving and supportive mom. You know, she was incredibly brainwashed by my dad for about like 8 years before I was born, you know, so between him and then essentially the system of friends and, you know, a somewhat institutional and organized system of trafficking and child abuse, you know, like it was, there's a lot of ways that it was hidden from her, essentially. So I am very lucky to say that she's in my corner, you know, and really like, you know, fighting the fight with me when it comes to healing, you know, and justice and all of the above, essentially. What ended up happening, you know, is very similar to like a lot of people, like, is that my dad, at some point early on in his military career, you know, got hooked up with other pedophiles. You know, my dad's a pedophile. He has a history of like of abusing essentially before I was born, you know, almost a decade. You know, I'm aware of like instances and stuff. It's something that he's always been. And if you are aware of like the porn that he was into by the time I was around, it's something that, you know, it's not something they just start off on, essentially, which was snuff porn. And that's something that, you know, I unfortunately am like incredibly familiar with, because it was something that was a particular favorite, you know, of my dad. He would abuse me a lot. That's a lot of really common memories, you know, by incest by my dad, you know, is, you know, growing up, you know, a lot of opportunities that he could find where my mom or brother were away from the house, you know, it would be, you know, finding essentially a film, you know, and abusing me, you know, while watching a film that's like someone being, you know, often like a child, you know, being tortured or killed, you know, in various ways. Like, and, you know, and that's where the anger really comes in, is not just to know that, you know, that these things happened, you know, but just to know that like someone could enjoy watching it over and over again, you know, while abusing their own kid, you know, like, and that's the kind of evil that most people choose to like turn away from, or just like want to believe it doesn't exist, you know, because it's like so different than their dad, you know, it's like how could, or how they would be around their kids, you know, how could that even happen, you know, but that's, you know, that's a psychopath, you know, their wiring is different, you know, I believe that once the wiring is that different, there's a spiritual component to it too, you know, like, and that really when it comes down to it, you know, anything that makes a normal human being happy, like the opposite is what makes them happy. So when it comes down to it, you know, that's, you know, the more power they can exert, you know, and the more like suffering and pain, which is evidence of the power they're exerting, you know, that they can witness, the happier, the more they get off, you know, that's their addiction, you know? So this is the kind of guy that essentially found my mom. I have a hunch, you know, that he was just looking for like a willing victim, essentially, you know, that he knew he'd be able to like, you know, to do essentially whatever he wanted. He was always having affairs, you know, often like, you know, like men and women and couples possibly, you know, and stuff like that. It was the side of his life that my mom did know a little bit about, essentially, you know, was essentially like the adultery and everything like that. But it also did set things up to where, you know, when first child came along myself, you know, a little girl, you know, I was, you know, I was essentially like a victim, like there and waiting. So with them, they were stationed, both of them military, medical field, were stationed all over the US. Went to Germany for a little bit prior to being stationed in Washington, DC, where I was born at Washington, or at a Walter Reed Medical, which, you know, a lot of people have, you know, mentioned before as having, you know, a very shady history and everything. But, you know, around this time, essentially, you know, he was, I don't know how else to say it. He was brushing shoulders around the time of my birth, a few years, you know, a couple of years before, you know, and after while they were stationed there, with a lot of like the high ups and big wigs, I guess, you know, is what I would say, you know, there was a lot of like high up military officials that he was hanging out with, you know, and there, I have a hunch that that's where he essentially met the person that, I guess, a lot of the abuse that I went through during my life was essentially geared to create, you know, a very specific kind of sex slave for a very specific person, you know, and that's, you know, that's a lot of my abuse that I went through, in particular, the violence, you know, just had to do in particular for, you know, who, you know, some people, you know, have the experience of being made to be, you know, slaves for politicians or different things. For mine, it was someone that was high up in the military, essentially. And so around the time of my birth, you know, he was brushing shoulders with all the big wigs and stuff like that. You know, he ended up, you know, visiting the White House a bunch. You know, I have no memory of myself being there as well, you know, because he was doing some medical work, with the president, Reagan, essentially. So, you know, he met, you know, the person that I was essentially going to be, you know, abused by longest, like around that time. I have my first abuse memory there at Walter Reed Medical. You know, it's the incest, like, kind of like, it's hard to know when something like that begins. A lot of people have that experience because the grooming is usually nothing that's like really painful or traumatizing in the beginning. And it's a very slow step up, and it's very started very early. So it's the kind of thing that crossing a boundary. So it's the kind of thing that you're already, you know, there's already part of you essentially, like when the abuse picks up with like a more like organized group, that is that the sex, like a sexual relationship with like, with a caregiver is already natural, you know, like, or is seen as like, you know, there's part of you that doesn't see it as wrong, you know, essentially, because it's been part of your experience your whole life, you know, but you know, that's
sensitized to it and conditioned.
Yes,
that
exactly.
That's like a normal, healthy relationship between a child and an adult. Mm-hmm. And like, there's nothing else to base it off of. You know, children learn that only from their examples, and you weren't shown that.
Yeah. I think that's the one of the main reasons that like most you know, why the trafficking organizations target, you know, the kids of pedophiles so much, you know, too, is because they know they're going to be abused. And in my experience, it's almost like each level of abuse or kind of like more organized abuse that you deal with almost like kind of like takes like an altar that's already been a part of you that's already been created essentially, and then kind of like piggybacks on it to, you know, kind of create like a different like version of it. So I have like a feeling that that's a lot of like why, you know, like the interest is, you know, is, you know, it's going to be the multi-generational thing that, you know, the dissociation is going to be more likely in, you know, subsequent generations, you know, the likelihood that you're going to become dissociative is higher with each generation that's abused. But in addition to that, you know, you're going to have, you know, like from birth and sometimes, you know, pre-birth, you know, like abuse that is essentially, you know, kind of like laying the groundwork, you know, for like later on a more like, you know, organized or structured, you know, kind of like, I don't know, path to take, you know, the dissociation and everything. That's really, you know, I think a lot, you know, a lot of why, like that, the memory for me, like my first memory at Walter Reed, I was probably around 2.5, you know, like really stuck out, you know, for me, because it was the first time I was abused by someone other than my dad, you know, and it was a real betrayal memory, like essentially being in a doctor's office, you know, and, you know, being abused by a doctor, you know, who is essentially, you know, my dad was sitting in the corner, and he was essentially trying, explaining to my dad how to like take the abuse to the next level with like by with but then kind of like both grooming but then also like being able to like do more abuse without like as much damage essentially, you know, because like I said, a lot of my stuff, and I think it was because too, like because I was like promised to someone that was a lot higher up, you know, like that there was always like, you know, like limits, it felt like, to, you know, both because they're keeping my mom in the dark, but you know, like I said, who I was promised to, he was fairly possessive. It seemed like there was always like limits to like, you know, certain things, you know, that could be, you know, done to me, you know. That being said, like, it's like, you'll find it's like some of the worst shit, you know what I mean? But it's like, it was very early on impressed upon me and other kids that were trafficked, you know, that like, that there were different levels of slaves, you know, essentially. And that you didn't want to be the throwaway kind, essentially. You always, you know, and that was a lot of the, you know, the trauma program, a lot of what it reinforces, you know, into, especially when you're in a place where they're forcing you to perpetrate or something, that's like, that's the goal, you know? And I think that's also part of why I was targeted for, you know, my particular abuser is just because of, you know, the psychopathic father and stuff like that, that it's like that a lot of times that is the hopes, I think, you know, with the groomers is that you're both going to have, you know, your child prostitutes, you know, and then hopefully future, you know, people that will still, you know, make money for the organization. But then it's like you also want always to be grooming more abusers, essentially. And that was a lot of my abuse was stuff that was geared towards trying to create in me something that was more like, you know, more like my, you know, my piece of shit father. So, yeah.
Yeah, and that is, you know, a huge part of it is trying to instill that psychopathic behavior in an innocent child that doesn't know that.
Normalize it.
Yes. You're right. It's like they don't get comfort. They don't get loved the same way as, you know, kids grow up with parents that aren't involved with these things. And it's like it takes away the child's, you know, innocence. And I know that sounds cliche, but like it's literally taking away their purity, their innocence. It's not creating boundaries for a child. And so it's like, you know, for people that haven't gone through something like this, I think that's also really hard for people to comprehend is like, how don't if the abuse can be so bad, how doesn't somebody like maybe recognize it, you know? And that can be adults too that have just been conditioned for so long and they get in unhealthy relationships over and over again. But you know, there's tactics and time and energy. Like if an abuser wants something, they will spend all the time, money, dedication to get it. If there's some type of a fetish or some type of, you know, as a specific thing that they want or a specific person or type of person, like, you know, these people will go through, like, there's no lengths that will stop them from getting what they want, you know, and they have all the patience in the world. And that's hard for normal people to think about. Like, why would you spend so many years grooming a child?
Well, they've got a lot of other playthings in the meantime, you know, is what people don't understand. They don't have, it's not like they're like, oh, this is one person that I'm going to wait and not abuse anyone else while I'm waiting for this person to get to the point where I can abuse them. Like, no, they're abusing as many people as they can in the meantime. You know, it's like it's this constant stream, you know, of victims for them, you know.
100%, yes. And so your father met this guy, this military official. How exactly did they meet? Do you know the exact details?
I have no idea, actually. And to be honest, like, I have a feeling that it might have been more on like periphery and stuff like that too, just because a lot of my initial memories that I had from this particular abuser, they didn't really start until I had gone through, you know, essentially what I would consider like what some people consider like beta training or like your, you know, your child prostitute, your sex kitten training, essentially. I didn't, it's like there was like several years essentially of like preparatory training for me prior to like meeting him. So as far as like knowing whether like they actually met or just met in periphery because they were both part of the same pedophile organization, I have no idea. You know, if I was just like picked out, you know, of like, you know, of like, you know, the other cult members that were having babies that year, you know, who knows? Like, you know, when it comes to that, like it's pure speculation on my part, you know, other than knowing, you know, that he was visiting the White House at the same time, you know, like my perpetrator was, you know, Sergeant Major of the Army. So that's pretty much the highest position that you can hold there. But a lot of my initial memories, like I had been saying, you know, was that my beta trainer, the second trainer that I went to after leaving Washington, D.C. and moving to Texas. He did a lot of like the interaction initially. So it was almost like my dad wasn't good enough essentially to interact with like with the guy that I had been promised for. So I mean, on a certain level, like I do enjoy, you know, I do enjoy that because for most of like my dad's stuff, other than like you said, you know, it's just pure gratification of his own, you know, will and desires and stuff like that, you know, is in regards to that is you know, him stroking his ego, which is pretty much, you know, like if I were to look at most of my abuse from why it occurred from my dad's end, you know, other than, you know, like I said, the sexual gratification for his psychopathic needs, like it was really about like I was just like an opportunity, any instance he could use to like brush shoulders with someone like more powerful and then vicariously feel like powerful because of it. Like that was like my whole childhood, basically. You know, he always needed to feel more important, essentially. And a lot of it, you know, even from my birth, like I said, it seemed like it was even what he did have was more based off of the fact that he was allowing people, a lot of people to like sexually use his daughter more than it was based off of, you know, his stuff. He did, you know, when he was working with Reagan, it was because of his like skills with like, you know, his particular field. But another thing that I enjoy is that, you know, he was always pissed off during my childhood that that they never mentioned him. His higher up essentially got recognition by name. So Another thing that, like, you know, we take our little wins where we can get them, because, you know, when we're dealing with psychopaths like this, you know, everyone like looks at them and is like, oh, they're like one of the best people in the family, and they have all their stuff together, and, you know, they're just so nice, and they go to church every Sunday. So, you know, how could they do these things, you know? And it's like, yeah, that's the point. They do these things so that they can, you know, they do all these good things so that, you know, they can create a facade to do all, you know, these bad things behind, and then create this plausible, you know, deniability and everything, which is what I experienced when I came out about my abuse, about like just the incest, even about like my dad and my uncle both, who had abused me. Yeah. So, one thing I wanted to mention a little bit, I guess, just because I brought it up already, is just so that people can understand, you know, just a survivor's perspective on, the dissociation and like the alters or parts and the splitting and stuff like that.
I just want to thank you do an excellent job at breaking this down. So thank you so much for talking about it. This is one of the hardest things, I think, for people on the other end to just grasp. You can hear it and comprehend it, but when you had told me what you're going to share on the phone recently, you know, it clicked a lot of things in my mind, and I know it's going to do that to people listening. So go ahead, girl.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah, so that's the one thing that I like to clarify with people, and I think it's helpful to survivors as well, as in addition to, you know, people that don't personally have the experience of, you know, being really traumatized and then having dissociative, like, you know, parts to themselves, you know. And that's just basically that, you know, from my understanding, that really helped me was that, you know, nowadays, like, the understanding is gotten a lot further away from that kind of like multi-personality disorder, Hollywood style, you know, like, I was gonna say like one person that goes through some overwhelming event, and then they just like, boo, you know, just split into a million pieces or something, you know, like that's a lot of times how people interpret it, is that you've had like, you have one thing that's whole that has become multiple. On a certain level, that's true, but on a certain level, it's really not, because how the understanding is nowadays is that, you know, dissociation more than anything else is a developmental disorder. And it's because of, you know, having like inconsistent and abusive, you know, severely abusive, like, caregivers. So we all start off as, you know, infants that have multiple personality states. You know, we have one for, you know, I'm hungry, I'm sad, I'm tired, you know, the infant can go like instantly from one to another, and like, you know, and for completely forget, you know, the last thing, essentially. So essentially, like, how it was explained to me by, you know, by therapists and stuff, you know, is that we all start off multiple, and it's our, you know, so we're multiple, and we have like our consistent caregiver that by responding to our needs consistently kind of helps us, you know, learn how to shift from one thing to another, you know, and then we kind of slowly, as we develop and get older, you know, we merge these all into a, like a cohesive personality, basically. So if we're still in the developmental phase, and all of a sudden, you know, like sometimes we'll have, you know, a very inconsistent like environment or caregiver or something, we'll go from having our needs met, you know, as you know, infants, toddlers, babies, or whatever, to all of a sudden a caregiver that you have to rely on your needs for is dangerous, and you have to run away from, you know, so you have that, like, that mixed feeling. So what ends up happening, you know, is that caregiver turning from a trusted person to someone who's essentially hurting you, betraying you, is like you're afraid for your life with, that essentially creates a dissociative split. Because for a normal child, like, they would never be able to continue to develop normally in a house if they were constantly aware that that person could turn at any moment. You know, it's that child would just not survive, or would become psychotic, essentially. You know, dissociation is like a step. It was essentially what prevents us, you know, as survivors from becoming psychotic, you know, is our dissociative disorder. So what ends up happening is, you know, there will be a little, most of you will not be conscious of the overwhelming event, and a small part of you will be, and that little part of you will essentially be, you know, almost like born in that moment of trauma. In that moment of overwhelming trauma, it's going to be switch from your normal state to this new state, basically. And in that new state, that moment is your birth. So whatever traumatic event is happening, that is your whole world. And then once that traumatic event is over and things are normal, it's almost like it's like a little compartment. And that's why I like using parts most of the time, because it feels like a shorthand for me of compartment. You know, it's like it's little compartmentalized parts of ourself, you know, that have just like been shut off, you know, from the rest of our consciousness. And, you know, and for that little part, you know, and that's why the trauma, that's why the PTSD, and that's, you know, all the triggers and everything for that little part, you know, it was born in that moment. That's its whole reality is abuse, you know, and then it's over, you know, and you'll get sometimes what people consider fragments, you know, which is sometimes like individual instances of abuse, you know, like, and like, you'll have like little kind of PTSD things that you deal with, you know. And then you'll also deal with, you know, what I consider, you know, like parts or alters, which are in, you know, how I understand it is essentially when the particular abuse that created this compartment is repeated, that same compartment is opened up in your brain to like handle the abuse a second time or a third time or a fourth time or a fifth time. And in a lot of times, you know, as often as that part needs to come out and be conscious, in my experience, you know, is like in what survivors call, you know, the internal world. We have a very vivid, you know, internal landscape, you know, where typically we can see, you know, the way different parts look or lit, like different areas that they live, you know, or sometimes for like people who are mind control survivors, like myself, we have a specifically structured, you know, like kind of structure for the compartments, essentially one that the abusers have intentionally created and are aware of so that they can, you know, then call out those different parts and have some control essentially. But regardless, any part we're talking about, you know, is just like a little is essentially just a traumatized child, you know, is like how I like to say it, you know, and the traumatized children, that parts of yourself that have, you know, been re-abused, you know, and come out to deal with a particular abuse. For example, you know, I would have one part, you know, to come out to deal with just abuse with my father. And then another part that would come out to deal with like a trafficking situation where it's like, I would be, you know, expected to sexually service multiple men at a time or something like that, you know, like there's different, you know, different parts that have different roles. And it usually, to me, on how I understand it, depends on the trauma, you know, is like, because that's the whole reason they're created, is to hold that trauma, but then also to like, when that trauma is forced upon us again, you know, to then, you know, to then come out to handle it, you know, and then, you know, hold it some more, basically. So those parts tend, in my opinion, to be a lot more like fleshed out, you know, tend to not be fragments, but actually have like what are, you know, more, people typically understand, you know, different genders. Sometimes they're not even human, you know, or they're different ages, you know, all kinds of stuff, you know. And really, that's because, you know, we're dealing with like parts of yourself that are blocked off when you're in a young developmental stage. And at that time, you know, our imagination plays a big role in things, you know, so we'll imagine ourselves at those times to be essentially what we feel like we need to be to handle the abuse. So that's why you'll get some people, they're like, how can you have a demon altar or have, you know, like a dog altar or all this different stuff? And it's like, well, there's a lot of programming to reinforce that sometimes intentionally, but also sometimes it's just what the mind of a kid does, you know, to just try and cope, you know, and that's what you get, you know. One thing, you know, that I would say, you know, is when it comes to that, you know, and that's a lot of what I think, you know, is what to me is, I guess, gives some shape to my story and the abuse, you know, is understanding, you know, like how the dissociation works, you know, and that you have these different altars, you know, that are created and are going to be naturally created if you even just have like an incestual situation or neglect or, you know, other like really severe abuse as a kid. And then you're going to have what some people consider, you know, not just DID, but DDNOS, which is where a DID system is essentially picked up by abusers that have knowledge of the developmental ages and when to do different abuses and what abuses to do to intentionally create these parts, you know, at different times of their lives, you know, so that there can be some control by the abusers on you know, what parts they call out for different skills, you know. But then also most of it is about this never happening. No. Most of it is about silence, secrecy. So you have these backup systems, and a lot of times with DDNOS, you know, which is this more controlled and structured version of DID, you have backup systems on top of backup systems of different parts that have been created through trauma, you know, through different abuse events that are, you know, all about creating an internal system of intimidation and, you know, essentially reinforcing all of their messaging and everything. So that was very much my experience, is that, you know, I started off, you know, in my original place of birth, you know, with like a very, you know, standard DID structure, you know, with like, you know, a few splits to deal with like my normal family life, which was most of my life, you know, and then, you know, parts to deal with my dad when he was sexually abusive, or at that point, someone else when they're sexually abusive, essentially. So once we moved to Texas, you know, they were both in the military and got stationed there, all hell broke loose. And I met, you know, what essentially I tend to call like the beta trainer. You know, he was always seen as just like a friend of my dad, a family friend of my dad, also a military medical field. But he had a daughter that was a couple of years older than me, who had been essentially being groomed as a child prostitute long before I had gotten there. And when I got there, I essentially was handed over to him, sometimes abused by both my dad and this guy. And sometimes it was just him, you know, essentially. But he essentially is the one that took the abuse from being something that was just kind of like random and incidental, you know, to my dad's urges, you know, into something that felt like it was very systematized, you know, almost like I was another like piece of meat on a conveyor belt, you know, that there had been many girls before me and boys, you know, that had gone through this stuff, and there would be many after, you know. And that's part of like why, you know, this situation, you know, is so fucked up and so overwhelming and stuff, is just to know that, you know, it, what I felt like I stepped into at that point was completely organized. You know, like there never seemed to be like any guesswork, anything like that. You know, it was always the mode that like my dad was essentially what some people would call like, you know, my handler, you know, but that, you know, he was just essentially following orders, you know, of higher ups as far as like how to take the abuse to the next level, and then essentially how to start, you know, trafficking me, you know, with this other guy.
And this other guy is the guy that he met in Washington that's high up in the military. Is that the same one?
No.
Okay.
So he is the in between.
Gotcha.
So okay. So we moved when I was about three and a half. And I did not meet, I personally have like did not meet, you know, the, as far as I remember, you know, that's hard when you're dealing with like dissociative gaps and stuff. But my first meeting with the person that like I was supposed to call master eventually was like, probably closer. It was like five, essentially. It was right before I was going to start school. So there was like essentially like, you know, like a year and a half there or so that like I was going through essentially all of my abuse with the beta trainer, who like, for to shorten things, you know, I'm going to call him Shmuel. And he's basically he was a medical field as well. You know, most of the people that abused me, you know, were military or medical or both, you know, essentially, other than some family members that, you know, that got in on the game, I guess, you know. But yeah, so Yeah. So Shmuel was essentially like, he had a narcissistic wife, you know, and then his daughter was essentially at the point where it's hard to say when you're dealing with someone who's like 8 or 9, you know, but the way she acted, she was already, you know, like a cut from his cloth, you know, and it's hard to see how that wouldn't be the case when, you know, you had a narcissistic mom, a psychopathic dad, and, you know, and she had been obviously going through the same stuff I had been, you know, from birth, essentially. Like, so there were a lot of instances where, you know, Shmuel would bring his daughter around, and we're just going to call her Susie for the podcast sake. He would bring Susie around a lot to essentially, when he would be doing a training session with me, he would bring her around to like role model the behavior that he was looking for, you know. So initially a lot of it was child pornography and trafficking related. So it was things about, you know, just learning to just how to perform sexually in general, or to have that persona of being seductive and stuff like that, you know. And a lot of it was, you know, was essentially like reinforcing, like when it's like she would do something right, you know, like what the right reactions were, you know, like as far as like, you know, like not complaining or just different things like that. They a lot of times used like other kids like to essentially make examples of, you know, in my experience a lot, you know. So, you know, so there was even times where it's like, you know, she was forced just to, you know, abuse me on camera, you know, with no adults involved, you know, and it's, you know, it's insane to know that you can get, you know, kids to the point, you know, where they can do that, you know. But that was very much my experience, is by being with this guy, is that we essentially, you know, that I essentially, you know, kind of just picked up the role of child prostitute, you know, and that a lot of like the initial training was, you know, was essentially creating someone that outwardly, you know, like would look like they were enjoying their situation, you know, and that's a lot of like what's really fucked up about it, is that you were, you know, that it was just constant, you know, abuse. And then like also like really fucked up positive reinforcement when you would do the things the way that they wanted, you know, and what they wanted, you know, was someone that would like perform sexually, you know. So for example, like one of my first memories of the blackmail machine essentially was being taken to an apartment that I had been abused in multiple times, trafficking wise, and there being a Shmuel there waiting, and then three other like young military guys, you know, they're probably like, you know, like 18, 19 or something like that, you know, and it essentially being, you know, at that point, like it was like, there was like a big show, you know, when things like, you know, especially if things were going to be like filmed or something, that like, you know, like on like, you know, props or looks of stuff, you know, so being dressed up in like a ridiculously frilly like pink dress and everything, and like, and all this different, you know, different stuff about being like, you know, like a party for me and everything like that. And then it like almost like, you know, just like any pornography, you know, kind of progressing, you know, to the abuse part of things, you know. And it was, you know, for that, you know, essentially like being forced to like orally rape, you know, like three different guys essentially, you know. And a lot of it, I think too, is like, it's both training for me, you know, it's like, that's the thing, like when it comes to like the trauma stuff, you know, like that's part of it, you know, is you're just, they're going to be putting you through a lot, you know, just to like reinforce like, you know, the trauma and the dissociation. But there's also, you know, there are other ulterior motives, you know what I mean? And when I see those three guys on the couch, I just assume that that's like where my dad was, you know, like when he was 18 or something, you know, that, you know, it was, you know, that the that, you know, this pedophile organization, they just, you know, they have their eye out, you know, for other psychopaths that, you know, and when situations like this, there was also an air of, you know, it's when you get multiple guys together, you know, that it's like the peer pressure, and then just like, just, you know, just all the stuff, you know, kind of like together basically that, you know, but for me, you know, like understanding like the different parts, you know, like that was, you know, for example, that time, you know, it's like, initially there was some, because it was the first time I had, you know, had to perform with like multiple guys, like there was some like resistance and everything like that, you know. And it's like, you know, it's like you just, you get taken to the, to like the next room, you know, and threatened and smacked around some until like, you know, and then like, and also kind of like triggered, you know, too, basically, because it was the sexual part based on my dad, you know, that they needed to call out. So it's like, you know, it was my dad essentially putting me in a situation that was triggering that part, you know, to come out, you know, until there was like a certain level of like, you know, there was an understanding, there was a switch and agreement there on how I was going to behave, you know. But I mean, that part in particular, like, you know, it's like, you know, was trained to like not have a gag reflex or something like that, for example, you know, and that was like part of, you know, just like part of all of it, you know. So it's like knowing that it's like you're saying, it's like that they'll have to like, that they'll go through so much shit just to like make, you know what I mean? It's like, you could just go into the bathroom and jack off. Like why all of this just to make, you know, the perfect sex slave, the perfect, well, you know, it's fucked up. Like it's really crazy.
It is. And like you were saying, like training, it's like they give you practice to get better at it. And it's like, they treat it like a sport almost, like they're training you for like a big game, you know, and like, practice these like horrific things over and over and over and over again to perfect them, you know. And it is, it's so sick and it's so hard for, you know, me and I'm sure you and everybody, like, how do you even wrap your mind around what goes through their head doing this, you know?
Yeah. And that's like really where I keep coming back to, like what you said in the beginning, like, you know, their strengths, you know, strengths are exploited, you know, and that's like, that's really, you know, what, that's really what it is, you know, like, and it is really crazy just to know how much, you know, I don't know how much they'll go through. The thing is though, too, is really understanding that there's more benefit, you know, than just creating those sex slaves. You know, it is like, it is the money side of things that people just have to understand, you know, it's like drugs, arms, all that stuff you can only sell once, you know, but kids you can sell over, and humans, you know, you can sell over and over and over again. So why that wouldn't be the main thing to fund black market things to me, like why that's so hard for people to wrap their heads around to me is just like why, you know, it's like, it's it, when you're dealing with psychopaths that have zero empathy, you know, they'll do this with their own, you know, with literally their own kids, like what holds them back from doing anything really, you know? So, and that's hard for people to really understand if they've never been around someone like that in their life. I bet you they have, but they haven't been aware of it, you know. But if they've never been abused by someone like that, you know, in their life, you know, it's pretty crazy, you know. Yeah, so actually, like and in regards to the trauma kind of stuff, you know, like that's one thing I did kind of skip over if we want to bring up the paintings, actually. So for the Texas ritual, because actually I started getting into the trafficking side of things, but actually my first like big experience was really a trafficking instance where I was brought to like a hunting lodge outside of the town we lived in Texas, and it was fairly far outside, kind of like hilly type country and everything like that, a little bit of like foresty type stuff around it. But essentially it was my earliest trafficking memory that I have essentially was that, you know, we were hired, it seems like, to come play a role. And I think a lot of it too is part of, you know, is this programming kind of side of things, is that, you know, they want to get you with as much of like the most fucked up stuff early on, because that's the things that really like lays the groundwork. It's like for those parts to then be, you know, further manipulated later on, you know. So like this right here is just like a scene of kind of like what I had walked in on. I was taken by Shmuel and my dad, you know, a little far outside of town to like kind of like a really ritzy hunting lodge, essentially. It had like, one thing I like to let people know is that like it seemed like it was like vacation home. It was told that it was a vacation home for like a politician, but I don't remember like who, and that but that full time there lived a doctor, essentially, who would do doctor things for the cult, essentially, on the down low. He was a retired doctor, but that's one of the main things I had remembered, is that I had been brought to the hunting lodge and essentially abused by the guy who lived there. That was like one of the main things that my dad was, you know, like proud about, you know, and had bragged about, you know, was that essentially we were invited there early before the ritual to, you know, to, for a trafficking instance, you know, for me to essentially be abused by someone important, you know. So that's something that my dad loved. And it was, you know, me being taken to be abused by him, like in this ritzy living room with all the taxidermy stuff. Off in the little doorway, you can see his little granddaughter that's like there waiting and like looking. She's going to be there later in the abuse event as well. When he left me to get abused by this man, he essentially was taken off, or the two of them went off because they're medical, to go tour the medical facilities there. So there was a couple outbuildings where, you know, I don't know what, you know, happened, but I would assume, you know, things like abortions or different stuff like that. You know, that's pure speculation on my part, but it's like, it was crazy. It was like a private, you know, middle of nowhere, like surgical facility. Like it's fucked up, you know. But that's also why, like, sometimes people have a hard time believing. It's like, oh, how could people go through these things or do these things? And it's like, when you understand, like, that you're dealing with psychopaths that have like a lot of money and resources, you know, it's not that hard to keep a lot of things hidden, you know. It's really hard for like people to comprehend, you know, if you haven't been on the inside of things. But it's like, yeah, it's like the number of things, like the number of fixes that they have for problems that we would think, you know, it's just infinite. And because they all work together, you know, too. So to help each other out in that regard.
And let me know.
There's the motorcycles. Go ahead.
No, it's okay. Let me know too when you want me to flip, because I know that there's three photos or three drawings in.
Yeah, so we can go ahead and flip to the next photo. So essentially, you know, after abuse event, the little granddaughter, like I was taken off. She just kind of went to show me around. She was like a couple years older than me. She just went to kind of like show me around the property, the stables and everything. And then like early on, essentially, like, because the whole time we were out at the lodge, there was really no one there other than myself, my dad, you know, and the people that seemed like they lived there. But, you know, it was essentially being brought, and this is kind of like the why I wanted to go over this with people, is just to kind of like set the scene some, so that people understand, you know, like how much goes into these fucked up things, you know, that happen, you know, and really like how widespread this has to be. Cause it's like, I mean, these are like I joke when I call them catered events, you know, but it's like when you think about the amount of like prep work that has to happen for all of these things, you know, and this like ritual space, which, and woods, you know, which what we're looking at here is essentially, you know, like in the surrounding woods of the place, you know, is that this is an area where they had rituals often, you know, a lot of times, like permanently, maybe like for a long time, because there were like, you know, set paths and clearings and stuff like that. So where we're at now is essentially looking at that there were a couple older women that were related to the man of the house, you know, that were cult related in black robes, that essentially took us, me and two other kids that had arrived. One of them was the little girl that had been showing me around, and then the other one, his name is Simon. That was the first time that I met him as well. I would be going to school with him later on, and he would also be part of like the mind control program and everything later on. He also had pedophile dad who abused him and everything. So it was essentially us being taken by these two women in black robes. You know, it was still daylight, you know, off down like, you know, a very large, you know, path in the woods. And there was kind of these side paths, and some of them would lead to, you know, clearings essentially. And we were brought to a clearing to essentially get ready. You know, they like, someone came and brought us like a chest, you know, with the robes in it for me and the other two kids essentially. And, you know, it was us, you know, being told to get dressed, you know, and to, but to keep fairly quiet, but we were still allowed to, like, you know, that's us there is playing sword fight with our sticks pretty much, you know, because we're kids, you know, and we were just pretty much like killing time essentially, you know, like we didn't really know, you know, none of us knew, I don't think, you know, except for the little girl that's like sitting off to the side, because like she, like I said, was like related to the cult, so I'm pretty sure she was aware, you know, of like what was going to be going on. She like wasn't running around and having fun like with myself and Simon. So and that is a fake name, you know, just so you know, you don't have to change that one for him as well. But essentially, you know, we spent a lot of time, you know, just killing until night fell, you know, and then it's like once it did, you know, off in the upper right hand corner, that's kind of what you see there, is like people in like black robes that we saw off down the path on the main path that had been essentially like filtering through to go to the ritual space basically. The person on the last one was like a person in a wheelchair, actually, that I remember like being like in robe. Like, it's almost absurd, you know, to think of like, you know, someone that's like in black robes and then in a wheelchair, you know, but you know, that's part of the, you know, that's what I'm dealing with, you know. So so essentially, you know, ritual space, you know, gets set up, you know, darkness falls, torches lit and everything. And then we're brought from our clearing to another one where essentially the dads had all been getting ready, and it was kind of same situation where like the little girl's dad was like very somber and not excited, you know, seeming, but you know, like my dad and Simon's dad were, you know, it was like they were at a party, and they were all dressed, they had all been dressed, you know, in robes as well. Theirs were white though. But yeah, it was basically like they were, you know, they were joking, you know, like it was like it was a good old time and everything. And then later on we were led down the path, you know, so it was essentially three fathers, three children, that were all like around, like, you know, like between the ages of like 4 and 6 essentially. We were, you know, we were brought to the, brought to like the main clearing. And that's like one thing that I like to like point out to people is, you know, it had all the typical stuff, you know, people standing around to watch in black robes, like a bonfire in the middle. If you want to go ahead and switch the next thing, that's kind of, I think that's the last one. Yeah, there we go. A big bonfire, you know, the altar in the middle. And that's one thing I like to let people know is like this altar, it's like, you know, it was made by someone, you know, a stone, you know, who makes gravestones or something. Like the amount of money and time that went into this big ass like altar, it wasn't going anywhere. So to me, it's all these little details to me that are just like indicative that this is like a big problem, and it has been a problem for a while, and it probably hasn't like gone away anytime soon. You know, it's like these are very like set up spaces and used more than once, you know? The one thing I forgot to point out from the previous one, but you don't have to go back, you know, was just that, you know, that one of the women, you know, had been holding upper left-hand corner, the older one had been holding a baby essentially the whole time. This ritual was going to include sacrifice. So that's why we gave the trigger warning, you know, is that, you know, when it comes to the ritual type stuff, it involves a lot of really fucked up stuff. And if it's too much for someone, for where they're at in their healing, you know, it's not a problem to like, you know, like I've done that many times to be like, I'll come back to this at another time. So I'll just say that. But essentially, you know, like everyone was given roles, you know, the little girl, had to sacrifice on the altar, a chicken essentially. Like everyone, it was the same situation where the knife is put in the little kid's hand, you know, and there's, you know, there's words and chanting and stuff. But the, you know, the father is obviously the one that has their hands over it and control over the knife, you know, for all of these instances and everything. So, you know, so for this one, you know, is the little girl was there, you know, to essentially sacrifice, you know, the chicken. The Simon and his father were there to sacrifice the goat. And then myself and my dad were there. And that was part of like what he had always like found special and bragged about, you know, was that we were chosen for, like, you know, like the like most special spot, which was to essentially be the one to sacrifice the baby. And that's a lot of why, you know, why I'm, like I said, like I'm here doing this, is because knowing, like, as hard as I had it, you know, there's a lot of, you know, innocents out there that have had it a lot worse, you know. And with this in particular, you know, is that, like, you know, it, as bad as my trauma is being up close and personal for this, it's just like, I mean, how can you not, like, your heart not break, you know, when you think about, like, you know, just a little innocent being, like, going through something like this, you know. But essentially, you know, like, he castrated him, and then cut open his stomach, so disemboweled him, you know, and then stabbed him in the heart before pushing him, you know, off the altar and into the fire. That's what they had done with each thing, with each victim. And you know, so I mean, it's hard to say, you know, how can you get more fucked up, you know, than that, you know. And just to know that this is something that wasn't a one-time instance, you know, it's just something else, you know. And that's a lot of, like, what you know, the trauma is in dealing with these memories, and why I think it's so hard for, and takes so long for people to heal that have gone through not just sexual abuse, you know, not just, you know, like trafficking and stuff, but when you start dealing with, like, the ritual memories, you know, it's, for some people, it's like, how do you even wrap your head around that kind of act if you don't have any, like, context for it, you know? And for me, that's one thing I've always tried to point out to people, is that, you know, we can look at these scenes and get very, like, you know, especially nowadays with how, like, everything's always, like, ritual everything, it seems like, you know, that is, like, it's very glorified, you know? And so it's like people can see these scenes, you know, and not understand, you know, that there's, like, that there was actual suffering, you know, that went on and everything. Like, I don't know, it's something that, like, you know, if, like I said, if you haven't been there and party to it, it's hard to believe that it exists, really, you know. But it's something that, like, you know, I don't like to, like, get specific about, like, what cult they were part of, because, to be honest, I don't know. And I don't think it really matters, like, when we're talking about these kinds of subjects, because when it comes down to it, you know, you're going to deal with cults, you know, that were more based off of more druidic stuff, based off of more Luciferian stuff, based off of, you know, fertility cult type stuff, or completely secular and just based off of, you know, some, like Nazi, like, you know, like, New World Order cosplay bullshit, you know what I mean? Like, it could be any of them. When it comes down to it, it's still the same psychopaths, and it's still satisfying the same needs, you know, that they have, you know, which is just, you know, they just get off on destruction, you know, and the more of it, the better. And the most destruction you can cause, you know, is of innocence, you know, like, when it comes down to it. So I'm going to take a quick pause for water. Do you have any questions for me at this point?
Well, I just want to comment and say, first of all, thank you for sharing that, and for sharing these graphics that you made. You know, it adds a different dynamic, I think, than just hearing it. And it's like the way that you painted it, you know, it's like you can almost see it through a child's eye. You know, it's like the details are kind of blurred out, like how a child wouldn't be able to put context to what they see.
Mm-hmm.
You see the colors and you kind of see, you know, you can make out what everything is, but you can't see the eyes, you know, you can't see exactly what's in the fire, but you can just feel this, like, dark energy and just, you know, not having the context to what you're seeing besides just how crazy it does look. And you're so right about that. You know, there is such a disconnect with society. And I think also to piggyback off some of the things that you said that contribute to it, you know, horror films in general are a whole genre of movie. Like, people will go make a horror film number one at the box office and watch it for entertainment, not understanding that it's not fiction, that just because the movie labels it as fiction, it's literally created off the ideas that these people do in real life, you know? And it's like they desensitize society to even like look at those things because of the whole, you know, neuro-linguistic part of it, where we're told that this stuff is fiction and it's beat into our mind from the time that we're little. You know, it's given an R rating. So it's like you kind of get excited to see R-rated stuff as a kid. It's like the kid version of turning 21 whenever you can watch a scary movie at age 13, you know, or whatever age it is. And, you know, it's really sad that people look the other way with this, because it is happening all over every country, every community, every city, every town, every state, you know, everywhere. And people have no idea because of how they've been desensitized to it, how it's been normalized in a fictional standpoint, and how anybody who tries to say it's true, they're just gaslit, you know, there's credibility given to this. And it's just absolutely heartbreaking, you know, and to just think about children going through this and, you know, the fact that even describing it as a party, like it makes me want to gag, you know, thinking, I think you mentioned they have like
cocktails. Every one of these rituals I've been part of have always been combined with a party for sure.
And your meaning, I think you had mentioned like a cocktail party, for example, before, like how sick that it's like watching a football game. Like they're getting ready to watch the Super Bowl. Like let's eat food and party and have cocktails and get drunk. And then
network, you know, just hang out.
And then the details too, like understanding that there's like a stonemason hired to like, and that stuff is not cheap to hire, like,
oh yeah,
you know, like how you said. So it's like even that deliberation, it's like it is really hard to wrap your mind around it. But like you said, when you understand that they have to hide it, and that this is literally like what they get off to, like this is what they live for, this is,
yeah, they do.
You know, this is like their social time. This is what they look forward to. They put the same effort into something like this that somebody else would into a birthday party or a Super Bowl party or a wedding. You know, it's like that much detail goes into it.
What they get excited about, you know, what I always use to describe to people, you know, who have a hard time, you know, just like in my daily life, wrapping their head around like a psychopath or something like that, is just, oh my gosh, I just lost my train of thought. Sorry. Oh man. Sorry. It happens from time to time. But yeah, though the main thing for me, like when it comes to people like visualizing like a psychopath, like for me is like I've always talked about, like, you know, like people can understand like the gay thing nowadays, like really easily, you know, like I'm bisexual myself. So I have, you know, I love everyone for who they are. But like when it comes like down to it, it's like for a while there, people had like, oh, like gay is a choice. You know what I mean? Like gay is like a choice, you know? And it was like, well, like, you say you're straight, like could you like choose to get your dick hard? Sorry to be vulgar, you know, for the opposite sex. It's like, no, you know. And that's like the thing that I have like to really to illustrate to people, you know, is like, because people, I think when they think about pedophilia nowadays, they think about like it as something that's like, oh, you know, I've heard it so many times in like truth or podcasts especially, you know, oh, you know, just what happens when you get super rich, you know, it's just what happens. Like when you've just tried so many things, eventually that's just what you try, you know? And I was like, how much money would I have to give you for you to get your dick hard in front of a crying 5-year-old, you know? It's like, it's not going to happen. Like that's the complete disconnect, you know, like that people don't have or don't understand, you know, is that like, that there's, you know, it's a level of understanding they're never going to have. And they should be glad that they're never going to have that level, you know, this idea that people have to like, oh, but why do they do the programming? Why do they do the trafficking? Why do they do all this stuff, you know, other than the secrecy and shit like that? It's because, you know, it's an urge that you will never understand. And you should be glad about that, you know, and just, you know, just understand that it does exist though, and try and do something about it. And for those people, like you said, it's like the, you know, the rituals, you know, those are the things that they look forward to. It's their time to be exactly who they want to be and be like, and and things that would normally in society that they would be looked down on, they get praised for, you know. Like I was in, you know, a alcoholic, you know, for like 6 years, you know, like in college and everything, just once I left the house, just trying to like understand and deal with all like my PTSD symptoms and just like, you know, just going into self-destruct mode and everything. And when it comes down to it, you know, like when I was in my alcoholic phase, do you think I wanted to hang around sober people? Fuck no. No, because like I couldn't relax and drink and get fucked up, you know, and the crazy antics that I wanted to do, you know, like if I was around a bunch of square straight people, you know what I mean? Like it's no fun, not even a little bit. So I would live for the times where, you know, it was, you know, like Thursday night and there's this thing going on, you know, any night of the week, you know, that you could find something to go, like there's something going on where you could go and feel like my drinking habit was normal. You know what I mean? And like, I could just do what I wanted to do, which was just like drown out the pain, just get obliterated, you know, like, and not feel guilty about that fact, you know? So really, you know, that's what people have to visualize is these people are addicted to pain, suffering, you know, like also they are typically also addicted to, you know, drugs and alcohol and all that stuff as well, you know, but they're addicted to these things, you know, and they're, you know, so it's not so strange to think that like psychopaths might network with each other, you know, like we're talking for me, like you said, I'm young for a survivor, but still like these events that we're talking about happened, you know, early 90s, you know, like, and it's like, this is before the internet. This is what, so obviously there was still a good amount of networking going on. I can't even imagine how it is nowadays. Oh. But it's like, but really, you know, they're going to find each other, you know, because they like doing the same things. They have no like attachment a lot of times to their own kids or different things. So that's part of why they're perfect for both being targeted by other psychopaths and other abusers and trading that content or those kids. But then also, you know, for like more organized like programs, like, you know, like we'll get into that are more into, you know, creating, you know, very intentional dissociative splits and stuff like that. It's, you know, you need the right participants for that. You know, you can't just take it and do it with anyone, you know, and you need someone that has that dissociative background. You need all that stuff. And that's why, you know, that's where this comes from. And I have a feeling too, like they're constantly, you know, there was always an era of like testing, you know, that was always apparent for me, like from the very beginning, where it was always about, you know, like putting you through a situation, seeing, you know, how you reacted and stuff like that. That was a lot of like what my, you know, the man I was like meant for, essentially, like that was a lot of like what, you know, strengths exploited, you know, that was a lot of like what he, you know, he was, you know, always so proud of, same as my dad, you know, that it's like that there were all these tests I had essentially passed, you know, which was essentially just like being able to survive and dissociate from really horrible, like traumatic events, you know? So, and for me, like I had mentioned, like this really was like the entry into like full on, you know, pedophile organization land. Like I had met Simon, like I said, and his dad, who was just like my dad, you know, very psychopathic, like had met him, also military, you know, pretty much everyone involved is going to be, but we started going to school together and we both went to the same school. My teacher was, I'm pretty sure, you know, an enabler for the cult as well. Just because like, she is very weird. She kind of followed me through first grade or kindergarten, first grade, and then second grade, and just always told everyone it's because I was her favorite student or something, you know. But it was always super weird. But the thing is like my mom was sent off for training a lot while we lived there in Texas, sometimes for a month or several months at a time, you know. And during those times, like there was a lot of time where I was like, you know, part of like the GATE program, and she would send me, you know, out of class for that, you know, or I was just, you know, out of school for just, you know, several days at a time for like, you know, these essentially trauma events like happening, you know, or trafficking events, depending on what the situation was. And my mom, you know, was never aware of any of this stuff. So I have a feeling, you know, that she maybe didn't report some absences or something, but it was also just the way she treated me. There's, like I said, there's always this air around me, like that everyone was always constantly testing you, mostly for like intelligence and stuff like that, like just constantly putting you through like, you know, different problem solving things, different, you know, just kind of
like any examples of that. Cause I know like the gifted program, that's something that's been brought up a lot.
Yeah.
Do you have any examples that people could reference, you know, of what like type of tests and like things that they put you through? That'd probably be helpful.
So no. And that's why it's hard. So there's like, so a lot of the things that happen during the gate program stuff, like it's going to be very mundane type things, you know, like, especially initially, like it was stuff like literally just, you know, things that you would probably see in a normal gate, like thing, you know, it's just, you know, working with like, for example, like, untangling knots or like spatial things, like a fitting things into like boxes or stuff like that. You know, a lot of it was essentially like about like it. It seemed like a lot of it always was about trying to decide where people's attributes were and then kind of like, you know, or rather strengths, you know, were basically. So for me, like it was always like really like impressed upon me, you know, that it was, you know, it was my problem solving abilities that were like, that was like, you know, what one of the main things that I was like sought after for. As far as like actual, like testing events, like a lot of them are like not traumatic. So we wouldn't remember them like anyway, but then when it comes to like the stuff that like was like me being taken outside of the classroom for that things, I think gate was just the pretext, you know what I mean? And, you know, with like a lot of those memories, they're essentially what I consider fragments, you know, like, so small programs that are just there to essentially, I think, like reinforce like, you know, the structure they've created and like, you know, the just like the trauma. So just putting you through a lot, I don't know how to describe it, like a lot of things where it was almost you know, it was being taken off site to a place that was more like, you know, like a bunker or underground storage facility type thing, and it being very why am I forgetting the name? Clockwork Orange, you know, very, you know, sometimes there's a lot of drugging involved, you know, especially in the trafficking type of stuff, you know, like, and a lot of like the different training things, there's a lot of times there's going to be like drugging involved, you know, either to sedate you or to create, you know, kind of like a suggestive hallucinogenic, you know, kind of effect, you know, so that's a lot of what's hard, you know, about like, about this, that whole kind of like suite of time essentially, is that things are very fragmentary. Things are very like, you know, there is a lot of like confusion of like things that were maybe being shown to me on screen and not necessarily in person, you know, slash some VR stuff, you know? So that's like also like where it's like, there's like very, like there are situations where it's very hard to like give context for, because like there's, you know, there's just, I don't know how to describe it. It's like the way that like information is being input into your brain is just so like overwhelming and just like different than normal reality that like it's really hard to like to put words to and stuff. One of the like the main instances, you know, that I've always brought up, you know, when it comes to this, you know, is and this was because I growing up, you know, I didn't have a whole lot of memories of my life, which is very common, you know, for DID people, you know, but there's certain things that really stuck out, you know, that were little things. And one of them was a gate trip where, you know, it was first grade, so it was I was six, you know, and they sent a bunch of kids, you know, a full bus full of kids with just teachers, no parents or anything, like outside, I think it's maybe like an hour and a half away or so to Corpus Christi, basically to like a state-owned aquarium there. And, you know, the memory that I'd had my whole life was just like, was just a single flash of like, you know, us being allowed to all of us sleep underneath the shark tunnel, essentially with all the light shining and everything and being able to see all the stuff. And it was all magical, you know, because of that. But, you know, dealing later on with flashbacks and stuff, you know, it was essentially coming back as another training memory, another testing memory, essentially, where they had been testing me for psychic abilities and stuff. And then it really sticks out to me because it was, as far as I can remember, the only test that I failed, I put through and I failed, essentially. You know, I couldn't do it because it was at a certain point they were like hurting my friend Simon in like the corner, essentially. That was like a lot of my memory was kids being taken out in twos after they had gone to bed, you know, to another room that was essentially like an interrogation room and being asked questions and stuff. And they were hurt, you know, they were hurting him and I think hoping that was gonna like, you know, like stress me out to the point where I was gonna do it or something. But it really all it did was just stress. All they did was just stress me out. I just couldn't, you know, it's like, I couldn't do whatever it was they were like. And it's like, I can't even remember what they were asking me because it's like the situation was like, you know, but it was just knowing that there was like, you know, it was asking about things on paper, things on cards, things in different places, you know, and it's just like, I wasn't able to get to do whatever it was that they wanted me to do, you know. So it was, you know, it was moving on, you know, from that. But they used Simon a lot, you know, against me. And that's sometimes too where I wonder if it was like an occult thing too, because his birthday was like one day off from mine, which is like super weird, you know, but maybe just a coincidence. But in any case, you know, a lot of like him being around, you know, was essentially always saying, you know, it was just more stuff to reinforce that like I had a slightly higher position as a slave than he did. And that, you know, like, so there was always this reinforcement that like, you know, and I think they probably focus a lot of that stuff on kids that they really want to be abusers, you know, is just this constant, like reinforcing of messaging that it's like, you're either an abuser or you're going to get you're abused, essentially, you know? So essentially it was just constantly being put in situations like where, you know, it felt like he was being made an example of, you know, to me, you know, like even an instance where it was like the cult trying to show you that they were all knowing. So they, you know, they set up a situation where he, you know, we weren't supposed to interact in school. So like in non-cult settings, we weren't supposed to interact, but that was a lot of like, he was always kind of trying to reach out to me. And like, I was always like, you know, my programming was always good. like was always really strong, you know? So I was like, I always obeyed, you know, like, so I pretty much was like, I wouldn't have anything to do with him. And then one day he brought me behind, and this is another memory I had always had, he brought me behind the desks and had like showed me his penis basically. And I immediately was just like, okay. And then went and told the teacher, but then later on, you know, and then she sent him to the principal's office and everything. But later on, you know, it was essentially being taken to like the bunker type facility again, you know, and essentially being like me being tortured with like, strapped to a chair, tortured by having my feet put in like hot and cold water. And like, you know, there's a lot of times like it was pinpricks, you know, on like ribs and feet or shocks and stuff like that, you know. And he was like essentially on a table getting anally raped by his dad, like behind me, you know. And essentially like the whole situation was, you know, creating, you know, this feeling like that, you know, we had done something to not obey, and they knew because they knew everything, you know, even though, like I said, I think the situation was set up for us to disobey so that they could put us through this situation, you know what I mean? And essentially, you know, just letting us know, you know, that no point in talking or disobeying or doing any of that stuff, you know, we were being punished, you know, and that, you know, in the future they would always know, you know, if there was something that we did we weren't supposed to and stuff. So it's that, you know, it's, you know, being an adult and going through that kind of situation, it's like, what the fuck, you know? But that's really like why I bring it to people. They're like, you know, why didn't you disclose till later, so long or different stuff? It's like, because when you understand like, you know, how overwhelming this stuff is just to heal with and deal on your own, and then to tell people about it too, you know, it's like, I mean, it's, well, it's, who can you it's tell? Stuff you would never even want to talk about, you know?
Yeah, they make it so like anybody that you don't have anybody around you that you even can tell, your teacher, everybody around you is an abuser. So they also make it very hard for you to disclose, not to mention, you know, all the programming, like you said, to keep you quiet. You know what's going to happen if they find out, like that fear that they instill in you of what could happen to you. is horrific. Adults cave to that, you know? They
Yeah.
are. Like, that's how they keep all the adults in check too, is through blackmail and through ways that they can manipulate them into staying quiet. You know, kids don't have any context to that. Like, they don't teach you, again, boundaries, safe emotional relationships, safe physical relationships. Like, you don't have any concept of that. That is like normal for you, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's like, of course you're going to keep quiet. Why would you say anything when you're, you know, your best friend or somebody in your family or yourself could have something so horrific as a consequence, potentially?
Yeah, it's true. And I have to say, there was one time, like when I was really young, like maybe like 5 or so, that I did at attempt to try and tell my mom like what I was going through, but like I barely started to get the words out. And like when I saw like the look on her face of just like, you know, like horror, you know what I mean? It's like I immediately backpedaled, because it's like, for a kid to like have like, you know, it's like they tell you no one's going to believe you, and like, and they're going to, you did something wrong and everyone's going to abandon you and everything like that. And if like, and it's like you're trusting to talk to like a mom who's like really loving, but then it's essentially, she was like my only like stable loving relationship in my life. And seeing that look on her face, it's like, as a kid, you just associate with yourself, you know what I mean? So it was just like, I was just like, dude, I am going to fuck up my one good relationship. So it's like, I immediately, you know, as a kid, I immediately, you know, was just like, I was like, oh, just kidding. You know, I was just, you know, I was just, I just put some marker on like on a paper, you know, said it was blood. It's not though, you know, and like, you know, I was just pretending and different stuff, you know, all this stuff, you know, as a little kid, to like backtrack, you know, and just like, you know, not have that look on her face anymore, you know, and it's, you know, it's fucked up. Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of, you know, a lot of this stuff, you know, that we've been talking about, you know, I think was like very like preliminary things for me to like be, meeting like who I was meant for, you know, is like, you know, I think a lot of like, even the trafficking was kind of like functional, as in like, it was, you know, like, yeah, they make money off of it, but I still think a lot more of it was just kind of creating the sex slave that they, a particular brand of sex slave that they wanted, you know, because that's a lot of like what all of this stuff felt like, is that it was testing, it was training, all stuff, you know, for, you know, kind of like preliminary crap, you know. And then once it's like, once I ended up meeting, you know, my, what should I call it, the person I was like, you know, meant to be like my master, and I'm just gonna call him Smeagol. So we have Shmuel and Smeagol.
Kind of like your owner, huh? He's almost like,
yeah.
Your-
So, but in any case, so Smeagol, you know, I ended up meeting him. It was, you know, prior to this incident we talked about with Corpus Christi and Simon and everything in school. It was just before I had started school, but it was after I had already started experiencing a lot of the trafficking, like I said, for like about a year and a half or so with the beta trainer Shmuel, you know. So you know, and that was a lot of different things, you know. Sometimes that was also, you know, that also includes, you know, like gang rape and stuff like that, you know. That's one of like my main memories, you know, was essentially, you know, it's crazy when you get memories back and you can hear like conversations, because there's a lot of times where like because of the drugging, I couldn't really move much, you know, but could still like hear what was going on around me and everything. So it's like, you know, it's like in that instance, basically, you know, it was essentially being drugged, you know, and having, you know, it's like 4 men, and they were all like still in like military, like kind of like their underclothes or whatever. So it's like, that's like a lot of it. It's like, I don't know if that was like intentional, like for stuff, like for the porn they were making, you know, or if it was just, you know, incidental or anything like that, you know. But, you know, it's like that instance, you know, was essentially, you know, a lot of it was just the logistical stuff of like, of child pornography, you know, like where they want someone to finish, you know, or the fact that the first guy essentially, you know, that they weren't supposed to finish inside of me. And the first guy did. And then just the all hell broke loose, you know, and then they like had to go and clean me up, and they just berating this guy who's like sobbing because he thinks he's like, you know, like in trouble, and their discussion, you know, about whether or not, you know, they would still be like fitting the bill if they just did the same film with three guys instead of four guys, you know, and everything like that, and deciding that, yeah, that's going to be okay, you know, and just moving forward, you know, with things. Like, it's like, it's so like, you know, or, you know, my first trafficking memory, even like with that, you know, also being drugged, you know, with that one. And sometimes it would be either something like in your Kool-Aid type of thing, or like with the first time I was drugged, it was actually being given an injection, because the apartment that all these trafficking events happened at, like, was like right off of like a walkway and stuff. So you wouldn't want someone being like too loud, basically. So when I started to struggle, it was like essentially being given like an injection. But for, you know, for that one, that was one of the later ones. It was literally just my dad being trained in how to produce his own child pornography, you know? So it was essentially, you know, being told different, like him, my dad bringing his camera, you know, along with the other guy, being told how to set things up, you know, how to like, you know, not have, you know, recognizable clothing or like bedding or anything like that, you know, different angles to do to not have like the perpetrator's face in and different things like that, you know, and to just like, that's like a lot to me, is like the things that it's like, you know, to be on like the inside, and it's like, everyone just thinks about this subject and they're just like child trafficking, you know, and they just like move on, you know, and it's like, but it's like to really know that it's like how much time and effort and everything like that, you know, that these people like really, really go into and spend their time on that. And most people don't even want to think about it for like two seconds, you know what I mean? I would love to get into like how I met, Smeagol, you know, the quote unquote master that I had been, you know, trained and kind of created for. But I'm going to grab some water first, if that's okay.
Yes,
with you.
Absolutely. Yes. I appreciate you so much. Like, you really do have a gift of breaking down hard things so they're palatable. And you do a really beautiful job, like kind of explaining it from a child's perspective too, which I think as an adult, we forget how to do that sometimes, you know, even in our own memories, we might, you know, recall them from where we're at now instead of where we were,
yeah, then,
you know, and that's such an important piece of understanding all of this, is like, we are so undereducated on, you know, trauma psychology and like how trauma actually affects us as adults, but we're vastly undereducated on how this affects children, you know? And so being able to like, see that innocence, you know, you look at that, those drawings that you had last time, like to like, you're playing with your friend right before like something so horrific is going to happen. Like just that pure innocence of like trying to trust your environment inherently, you know, and like trusting the people that you're around and just being a kid, you know, and just seeing that, like how they manipulate all of that and understanding what was going through your head. You have a really beautiful gift of being able to kind of combine that so people can hopefully have empathy and like really be able to put themselves in the shoes of that child. And I think when we can do that, that's when we really start to care.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate it. Well, thanks for being here with the platform, you know, to do it.
And I didn't mean, I know you're getting a drink, but you can go ahead and talk about how you met Smeagol.
Yeah.
Kind of rolls off the tongue a little bit.
Yeah. Oh yeah. So this piece of shit, he's like in his 80s now, so that's like, I mean, like all honesty, that's like part of like why I'm like, you know, I had been planning on disclosing anyway, you know, because of all the reasons I had said initially, you know, survivor help and help for kids, they're still part of this stuff, and hopefully one day that the weight of our voices will achieve justice and everything. But that's also part of it too, is it just, it pisses me off when I have abusers that have been able to fucking pass away without ever, like, you know, having anyone call them on their shit, you know what I mean? Because they, you know, they're all of them just have this attitude that they're like hot shit and their shit, you know what I mean? It's so
they think they're untouchable. I don't know. They think they're untouchable.
Yeah, exactly.
They are, because it's like you said, they create networks to protect them. They have lawyers, exactly. Networks, doctors, secret locations, anybody that, you know, any amount of money or any position of power, police officers, ER doctors, like they create the perfect network. So they do get away with everything, you know? So it's disgusting.
Yeah, definitely. I was pretty much going to get into talking now about the piece of shit who thought he could call me master for a lot of my life, basically. And I have to usually, I really need like to always preface, you know, like my interaction with him, like with like people understanding, you know, like our first meeting, like, because that's a lot of like what we had mentioned before is like understanding like all of these things, like the way these situations are set up, you know. It's kind of really sad that like it feels like, you know, like mainstream therapy is catching up to like understanding these like developmental ages and all these different things that it seems like on a certain level psychopaths have understood, you know, for many years, you know, is like and really understood, you know. So, you know, trauma bonding is like a huge part of things, you know. It's like, it's not, you always want this, they always want the Stockholm syndrome. You don't want someone to be quiet just because they're afraid, you know, because then there's potential they won't be afraid, you know, one day. It's always also that they're going to be trying to create, can you hear me okay? Oh yeah. That they're trying to create in these people, you know, parts of them that are modeled after the abusers themselves, you know, are essentially convinced that they're either like the abusers or the abusers themselves, or in some way, you know, it's a protective mechanism on the inside. It's basically Stockholm syndrome, you know, where you're like, they purposely put you in situations where it's like, I would rather be allied with the abusers against unknown than, you know, it'd be me versus the abusers, you know. So there's a lot of this programming conditioning that's there, just to kind of create these almost like, you know, mental traps, you know, for the survivors to like, you know, we're, even if the abusers aren't around, we're going to be internally reinforcing the same thoughts, the same lies, the same everything, you know, like even without, you know, the abusers being around, sometimes for years at a time, you know. So when it came to meeting this guy, you know, he was presented to me as my savior, even though he was the one that perpetrated, probably other than my dad, you know, the most abuse on me over the course of my lifetime. I was five right before kindergarten, essentially. And I was given to by my dad to Shmuel, the beta trainer, essentially, to take me outside of town somewhere. I was dressed all up which I had been used to be doing, you know, is getting dressed up in like some sort of outfit or costume. I had been dressed in kind of like a, you know, really frilly, poofy white princess dress and did a little white flower crown in my hair and everything. And was, you know, was apprehensive because you're aware that it's like going to be a trafficking event, you know, but didn't know like what was to come. Just that, you know, I was just with Shmuel only, you know, kind of driving, you know, towards, you know, like some woods again, like outside of town. And essentially, like once we got there, you know, there was a big show of him, like, you know, driving off the main road and down a dirt road and then into like an like middle of nowhere where there were essentially six men in black robes that were waiting. And they were waiting to, they made a big show of like essentially selling me to them, you know, and making it seem like I was being sold to them and was not coming back, you know. So like the level of like, you know, creating all these circumstances to create this level of like of terror, essentially, you know. And then once you're handed over to these six men, it was being told, like led into the woods by them and being told that it was, you know, and I had already been to a sacrifice ritual, you know. So being told by them, you know, that now I was going to be sacrificed, that essentially they were going to summon demons that were going to essentially rape me and then kill, and then eat me, you know, alive, basically. So, you know, so essentially it's being dragged out, you know, into the middle of the woods, you know, and then, you know, being left, told not to move, and they all step back in a circle to do their chanting and everything like that. And out of the woods, you know, from behind them come six demons, basically. So, and these are, you know, looking back on it with adult eyes, you know, obviously just people in, like, you know, in suits, essentially, you know, like kind of ghillie suits with all the stuff hanging off of them, you know, in big scary, like demon mask type situations and everything. So, you know, but as a child, you're like, oh my God, you know, they just summon demons, you know, like here, that's part of this ritual to like, you know, to like rape and kill me. And that's like what, you know, they did start, you know, pawing at you and everything and like ripping your dress and like, you know, and like, you know, it's like when the terror is like essentially at like, you know, the worst, all of a sudden out of the woods on a white horse comes, you know, Smeagol, my, you know, my future master. And he's dressed as, like I said, my savior. He's riding a white horse. He's got, you know, the horse has like more like, you know, silver type bridle and like little armor bit to make it seem like more like little more unicorn-esque, you know. And he's also dressed in, you know, the frilly white, you know, like romance novel, you know, shirt and everything, and you know, the breeches and a sword that he draws to, you know, scare away the demons, you know. And you know, and he makes a big show of essentially scaring away the demons and saving me. And, you know, explains that, you know, I'm the princess he's been looking for. A lot of like my programming and the imagery, and it's probably because of my particular abuser, seems like a lot of it was built off of like kind of like more medieval kind of stuff. You know, a lot of abusers have the more like satanic Luciferian type stuff, but he was a little bit more like into more like the medieval druidic, like play acting, like knights and castles and all that, you know, more going to say more like Ku Klux Klan, you know, style of things, you know, basically. So, you know, he basically, you know, he tells me that he's my savior, I'm the princess he's been looking for to be his queen, you know, and then proceeds to rape me, you know. But in my mind, you know, as a kid, you know, you're like, well, you know, yeah, this sucks, but it's like way less sucky than, you know, getting like gang raped and eaten alive, you know. So it's like it was really kind of like solidifying in my mind, you know. And then he discusses with the men in black robes that I'm his property and that I'm not allowed to be sacrificed and stuff. So there's a level of gratitude, you know, there on multiple levels, you know, that it's like I'm chosen by him, I'm saved by him, you know. And really, you know, this level of like, you know, the Stockholm syndrome, where it creates like a level of like almost like loyalty, you know, where you feel, you know, like, you know, you're part of the same cause or something, you know, with them, you know. So that's a lot, you know, of what I had experienced initially with him. But that was by far like the nicest that he had ever been with me. My abuser, Smeagol, was he thought he was like the baddest motherfucker on earth. Like that's how most people like even like describe him, like essentially his nickname was the snake, you know. So he like and he was just like Vietnam, like did a lot of bayonet training, marksman stuff like that. So the way I like to describe like a lot of like what I went through after meeting him, you know, and once he kind of took up the training essentially for me, was what some people consider in mind control terminology delta training, which is training to be violent, you know, to be essentially an abuser, a perpetrator, you know, a killer, different things depending on your role. So for him, you know, his shtick was always, you know, about being hard, cold, badass, you know, a fucking killer, you know. It was always about training, even when he was just like on his, you know, outward persona in the military, basically. And but he was all about, you know, like I said, like marksmanship, bayonet type stuff. So what I like to describe to people is a lot of like my violence training that I went through was really just to satisfy his sick pleasures, really, because it's like there's just some people personality wise where like they're gonna want the vapid blonde haired ditzy sex kitten, or they're gonna want the poodle, like I mentioned before, the poodle on the leash, you know, they're gonna want that status symbol, but it's like, you know, it's just luxury or just whatever. And then you're gonna have other people like dictators who they want a tiger on the leash. They want something, you know, they don't want just bodyguards, you know, they want like their fucking sex kitten bodyguards, you know, who are both because that's on a certain level for those particular breed of psychopaths, that's something, you know, that to them adds to their delusion of grandeur, really. I think, you know, that they're not just dominating something that's helpless, they're dominating something, you know, that's dangerous, you know. And I think that that's like a lot of like my personal stuff that I went through then from then on out was about, you know, was that, you know, it was a huge desire to create in me, you know, essentially an abuser, a perpetrator, like someone that was going to be doing a lot of violence essentially in service of, you know, in service of the cult and stuff. And a lot of that training for me was in the form of being put in a kennel. And that's one thing that I hadn't mentioned before is that, so like I'd mentioned, like the groundwork for like the parts that that Smeagol took up was created by Shmuel, you know, when I got to Texas with all the initial sex training. So Shmuel had essentially created, you know, a sex part that then, you know, like a prostitute kind of part, you know, that then Smeagol was able to take up and was your, you know, your Manchurian candidate sex kitten, you know, assassin type thing, you know, so someone who's going to be both sexual but is a little bit more sadistic and like able to, like, you know, even though I was never used for it, you know, I was at least trained in being able to, like, you know, being able to, like, you know, kill someone by, you know, slipping, either poisoning or stabbing, like basically, you know, type, so knife work, you know, which he was obsessed with because of all his bayonet stuff, basically. So so really a lot of the violence kind of stuff was like, you know, was him creating these different altars that were geared towards him, you know. So there was the sexual one, there was also a non-human altar that was based off of a dog for the beta training for just the pornography, and all of that training happened in a kennel that was outside of town. It seemed like it was more of like a long-term boarding type facility and also had like a vet's office and stuff. But there were many times very initially early on when it was just the sex kitten training, you know, where I feel funny saying sex kitten training because for me it was never cats, it was always based off of dogs, you know. But essentially, you know, it was the sex training with, you know, being left for long periods of time in, you know, kennels, essentially, you know, the stainless steel like dog kennels that have like the, you know, like just like the great fronts you typically see at vet's offices or anything like that. Like they would have one that would be wheeled into like this like indoor space that had like fake grass and stuff that typically most of the training and the bestiality scenes would occur in. And they would like wheel in essentially this kennel. And that was essentially seen, a lot of the training for the dog altar was to associate your kennel, you know, as home, as the safe place, you know, so there would be a lot of abuse, but then, you know, you just associated getting put in the kennel as a place that, you know, that made you feel safe because you weren't going to be abused, you know, so there's a lot of things that they do, you know, and also, like I said, drugging, you know, so sometimes I think in these instances, there was like LSD or even like alcohol, you know, that were involved, you know, where initially with a lot of these kennel instances, like it was literally just like me and like dogs, you know, with other dogs and stuff. And then it amps up to it being bestiality and now like it being filmed, you know, and there being that involved, you know, being essentially like myself and Susie that were being essentially like raped by dogs on film, you know. But a lot of the training also was like terror related. So being left in a kennel, you know, for long periods of time, not knowing when, you know, someone's going to come back, having things like like kittens be like mauled in front of you by like Rottweilers or stuff like that, you know, just a lot of like really, really horrific things, you know. And the groundwork for essentially for this dog altar was then later on kind of picked up by Schmiegel for the violence training with essentially a wolf altar. So towards the end of the training with Schmuel, there was instances where they put you through, and this is how they create like an abuser really, is they put you in an instance where they're forcing you into, you know, in my case, it was killing a kitten. It was drowning a kitten, you know, and a little kid would never be interested in doing that, you know. But after they've shown you this much trauma, you're being, you know, pushed around. Like a lot of my stuff was like, you know, them, you know, torturing you with just like, you know, and as a kid, you know, it's still horrifying, you know, just being sprayed with really, really cold water or really hot water, stuff like that, you know. And essentially, like, and you'll refuse, you know, because there was no interest for me to do it, you know, over and over again. And they'll try something else, and they'll try something else, you know, to get you to like, essentially agree to their request, you know. And essentially, I still wouldn't do it. I still couldn't do it, you know. I couldn't kill this precious little kitten, you know. So, you know, their last thing was for them to just like leave me, you know, like wet and alone in the room and leave and like turn off all the lights and basically tell me that the, you know, the Rottweiler was going to be in soon to to tear me apart, you know. So it's like, you know, so, and that's like where understanding people for like, you know, the parts and stuff like that, it's even remembering in that instance, you know, having the argument in my head between, you know, a couple of different parts, you know, essentially like, you know, where there was, you know, it was realizing, you know, that it's like that there wasn't going to be any way out of the situation essentially, you know, and that like we were going to die, and essentially that there was, because we believe them 100%. So, a part essentially just choosing to be like, I'll do it, you know, essentially, and, you know, and crawling to the door and calling to them and being like, we'll do it, you know. And that's, you know, and that's what, you know, that's how it happens, you know. When it comes to the abuser training, is, you know, they're gonna push every button they can until you agree to do what they want, essentially, you know. And that's really what I experienced, you know. And that's what happened, you know, is I, you know, they came back in, and I ended up drowning a kitten, you know. And it was, and it, like, it still was, like, and even today, you know, is, like, one of, like, my harder memories. I mean, they're all really hard when you understand, like, what I'm dealing with, you know. But essentially, you know, that's the kind of stuff that was just even preliminary training for what then Schmiegel took up as, like, as a wolf altar. And for that, you know, it was... you know, he wanted me to be a hunter, basically, you know, like that was like what all of it was about. But it wasn't just me, because that's the one thing I bring up to people, is that the training I was going through when it comes to the violence side of things, there were other kids there too, you know. They were considered part of like my pack or something, you know, and they also were put through similar things, and you're used against each other. And a lot of times initially, even for that, for play, you know, play acting, hunting each other and stuff like that. And then, but then the rewards and punishments, you know, for good behavior and bad performance, you know, and all that kind of stuff is, you know, is very horrific, you know, is, you know, being forced to like eat feces or different crap, or, you know, like rape, all kinds of stuff, you know, that you're going to have to do if you don't perform well, you know. So it's a game, but not really. And then things essentially stepping up from there to being about, you know, hunting, like, and this is all taking place at this kennel and like the surrounding land, essentially. Like there was a lot of like rabbits and cats at the place, you know, that were on hand. So it's like they would have rabbits or cats that had been like drugged or lamed or something, you know, to make them like catchable, I guess, essentially, for us. Cause at that point it was more about the fact that we were able, you know, they didn't want to give us like a normal rabbit or cat that we would just never be able to catch. And they would just like laugh, you know, like, because they wanted us to catch him so that they, you know, could essentially force us to kill him. You know, that was like the whole point of once that's like where the exercise had gone, you know? essentially, like, it was the gate stuff, you know, was all in this time. So a lot of me being out of school was to do a lot of this more like violence related stuff. It was going to be testing type things, but also at that point, it's like, I kind of already had a little bit of a role, of a job, essentially, that I had. So at that point, it was just essentially kind of like, I was already on like my training path, essentially, like, you know, my program path, and like, and what they were trying to create out of me. A lot of that, you know, did have to do with the fact that my dad was in the medical field. So the we can go over the Wolf Altar and the New World Order kind of style of training there. But just briefly, I'd like to go over just like the last kind of bit of stuff was essentially the occult training, basically. So there was, you know, like I said, there was like the sex assassin part, there was like the wolf hunter part. And then the third part that was created, you know, for him was based off of the ritual abuse. And that was the fact that, like, I don't know how else to describe it other than that my role for multiple rituals that I had been trafficked to by him, you know, throughout my life up until, I don't even know, up until college, to be the butcher, essentially. Like, so at a ritual, you would have, you know, it's like, you sometimes you'd be both the executioner and the butcher, but sometimes it would just be the butcher. So a lot of my stuff, my training when I was outside of school, was just about like going to morgues, like anatomy knowledge and stuff like that. So understanding anatomy of both like animals and people and everything, and just understanding kind of like butchery type skills and stuff. So like dismemberment and like skinning, for example. So essentially, like with that, you know, kind of stuff, it was, and when you understand the kind of psychopath that he was, you know, you understand, and that my dad too, you know, like I said, his favorite porn was snuff porn, you know, it was people being burned, being suffocated, you know, just the, you know, the worst stuff you can imagine, you know, like that. It's, you know, he would obviously have no problem, you know, with this kind of stuff. If anything, like I said, like all these kinds of things, he vicariously like thought like he got some sort of like thrill out of, you know, like somehow he was special because I was chosen to do these different things or to be used for these different things, you know. So that would be like my role essentially in different occult events, you know, would be to do the serving of the black mass. I don't know how else to say it, you know, but it would be to, you know, to essentially be, you know, like, you know, draining someone of blood, you know, serving the blood, you know, like being able to like pour things neatly. Like, I don't know how to describe it. Like, that's each part has skills, you know, and that's like the butcher. That's one of the main things that was a big skill for like that part, you know. That part was just, you know, just being able to like pour things well, you know, doing just different stuff like that. It's like catering stuff almost. It's like, but it's with cannibalism. So it's like, it's pretty much the worst shit you can imagine. I've struggled with nausea a lot of my life for this reason, you know, it's been pretty difficult. It was a period of time in my life, you know, like essentially 5 to 7, where I was just doing a lot of this, like this training into learning about how to be, you know, to be violent essentially, and how to have these different like skills when it came to that kind of stuff, so that I could be just used for it later on, you know. But like I said, I think it's just because the abusers also get off on the fact that they're making, you know, making us victims do these things, you know. So I had like, there was like a culmination event essentially that was it was a human hunting event that was him, that was Smeagol and two other handlers with their two other like kids that had been being trained for the wolf stuff too, essentially like being taken out from the kennel to a like further out, essentially like into as far out as we could go, essentially into like kind of a more deserty type area, and meeting I guess a human trafficker, you know, like a coyote or something. It was a guy in kind of like a beat up kind of red Cadillac style car. And he essentially had three kids. So it was two little boys and myself, and then the handlers, Schmiegel, and then the two other. And then it was the trafficker, and he had three little kids that were almost identical, but they were three Mexican kids. They didn't speak English. So a little girl and two boys. And it was pretty much like the event was seen as our graduation, you know, the culmination of our training, where we were supposed to like hunt people for real, essentially. And that's a lot of like what that whole experience was about. And honestly, like a lot of like my guilt that I've had to deal with, even being like a little kid, you know, but because of how high up my master, Schmiegel was, you know, I was seen as the leader of the pack. So it's the fact that even that I led the hunt, you know, is something that's like, that's really difficult to deal with, you know, or the fact that, you know, how a little girl, you know, just the way she looked at me the whole time, like, you know, when I finding them and bringing them back to these abusers, you know, like the little boys being forced to eat feces and the little girl being essentially gang raped by the three different men and stuff. And to just know that, like, that she was just seeing another little girl that was there and just not understanding like why it was that I could be participating in this stuff, you know? And it's like, but it's hard to describe to people that it's like, for that part, that's your whole reality, you know? Like, that kennel is home, you know, that guy, that Smeagol, that is your master and responsible for your whole livelihood. And that's not someone you're going to risk displeasing, you know, and for that, and at that point too, you know, like I said, it's culmination of training. It's like, you've done so much other fucked up stuff like that. For that part, it really, you really are completely dissociated from your emotions. You see yourself as a wolf, you know, that's how I saw myself in that memory, that I was not a human being, you know, that I was, you know, that it's, you know, you feel like this disconnect that someone's just prey and not like, not a, another human being, you know, but it's what's, that's the amount of trauma they have to put you to put those walls up to where we can really, you know, create that compartmentalization and everything. So, yeah. So she was, you know, she was gang raped. And then Schmiegel essentially, I don't know if he killed her, you know, or if it was us kids, you know, but essentially it was him like holding her up, but his hand was like over her nose and mouth, like both essentially, like, and like forcing like us three kids to essentially like to stab her basically. And then once she had passed away, you know, it was, you know, he like took her right nipple and cut it off and ate it. And then told us that we also had to do the same thing. And pretty much the whole instance was like, you know, was pretty much saying that it's like we were either wolves and allied with them and like, and this, or we were little boys and girls, and this is kind of, and we were shown kind of what happened to little boys and girls, you know. And so it was just kind of more stuff to solidify like the thought in my head. That was a big part of healing, was realizing when my therapist said if the police showed up right in that instance, they would not have arrested me, you know, like a little 6-year-old, you know what I mean? Like, they would not have arrested me. They would have taken me into protective custody too, even though I was being forced to do horrible things, you know, like, and that's a huge part of healing, is like you said, is really looking back and understanding how young and manipulated we were, like for all of these events, you know? And then later on, when we're dealing with recall events, where they're calling out those same parts, understanding that they're still manipulating a really young part of yourself, you know? And that's like, you know, that's hard to wrap your head around, you know? So I was essentially like promised two things, like, for completing my training. And one of them was that I was going to go to a really big special event or big special ritual with Schmiegel. And then the other one was that I was going to go to Disneyland. So, the ritual event with Schmiegel was essentially us being, Schmuel and Susie, his daughter, and Schmiegel and me, and then my dad. Actually, it was my dad. I remember being excited about being included in this, because like I said, for most of the abuse events, like, he was like, the guy would only interact with Schmuel and didn't really and wasn't really interested in interacting with my dad personally. But there was a facade that we were having to maintain, like, because we were all getting on a personal private jet and flying, you know, from Texas to Washington, D.C. For a big party and ritual event. And the plan was to be there for several days. So my dad was around for us to essentially like have, we could call my mom, where when my mom called, you know, initially he was in the same room, but then I was just handed over to this guy after like the first few hours, you know, and anytime my mom would call or they would set up the call for my mom, you know, it would be us like on a three-way call, all pretending, you know, that we were around. But my dad was just out like with Schmuel the whole time we were in Washington, D.C., and I was being trafficked to Schmuel, you know, if he was just out just getting drunk and partying and stuff like that. Like he had zero concern, you know, for me and where I was at, you know. So when we got there, it was, you know, going to a flat and being, you know, like being abused some, but then also being gotten ready, you know, even by a maid or someone, you know, that he had, and being dressed in a very adult satin gown, you know, that was low cut and didn't have a back, big slits up the leg. It was a red satin to match his shirt. And he had a gold mask to match his gold sun mask, essentially. And then he had black pants, black cloak. And it was very Eyes Wide Shut. You know, it was a really nice ritzy location. You know, there was a ritual where myself and the other child sex slaves were like kind of for the beginning part of it, we were just kind of like put off in a room. And then when the ritual began, we were all arranged in a circle, like on the outskirts of the ritual, just to kind of like observe. And then after that, we were all kind of rejoined with our, you know, quote unquote masters or whatever, to just be essentially abused by them for, it was like, you know, cocktail party / orgy afterwards, you know, so abused by them. And then anyone they chose to share you with. But essentially, like, I had 2 or 3 days of just being with this guy in his apartment, you know, and just being used by him. One thing I like to let people know is that as big of a man, as hard as he liked to say he was, when it came to sex, like he was interested in me always being drugged to the point of like being like a sex doll, being like completely non-responsive, as in zero resistance, you know. And if I wasn't, then I had to pretend, you know, that was the case, you know. So real big man, right? But essentially, after a couple of days of being kind of like used and drugged by him, I'm not sure which, I had like kind of a near-death experience, basically, where it seemed like I left my body, and I don't know if it was like an OD from the drugs or if it was just shock, you know, from all the stuff that I had been going through, you know, because a lot of, you know, it's when you're dealing with like, you know, rape and anal rape and all that kind of stuff, when you're dealing with like kids and stuff, you know, it's, you know, damage can be done, you know? So it was essentially me like leaving, like it's a very vivid memory of me leaving my body, you know, and being brought to like a hospital and essentially having a conversation with my higher power to, you know, decide if I want, you know, if I wanted to go back, you know, and higher power understanding that if I didn't want to, you know, that it would be okay, you know, too. But essentially that's where people have to have compassion if they're early in healing for parts that are seen as evil or allied with the abusers, is because in my experience, that's the part that stepped forward to say, I'll take this burden, you know, like I'll do the bad things, I'll fucking hold the bad things I need to just for us to survive, you know. And like, and really in healing, like I think that's where a lot of healing comes from, is when we can understand those parts of ourselves that did feel so like allied with the evil people in our lives, that we can really see, you know, that like that it really was just part of ourselves just trying to help us survive, you know, something that, you know, that no one should ever go through. So that was really tough, you know. It was, you know, having a memory of my dad being drunk, you know, and showing up at the hospital and everything, because obviously I lived, you know, and survived and stuff. And but you know, that was all during, my mom was away for training often, but that was actually during my mom's, when she was pregnant with my brother. So she was kept for like 3 months in a military hospital during that time. So who knows how much of that was like legitimate, you know, or how much of it was motivated by, you know, just wanting extra time, you know, with me, essentially. But yeah, they ended up retiring from the army right around that time though, and we moved to Arizona. And the abuse pretty much just kind of continued there, much less of like the trafficking and pornography side of things, almost none, you know. Like I said, a lot of that was set up, it seems like, for, you know, creating the trauma to create the parts, you know, for this guy. Cause for the most part, after that point, once we moved to Arizona, I was trafficked, you know, here and there to people, you know, especially if like my dad or someone saw them as like important, you know. But for the most part, you know, Smeagol was fairly possessive, you know, and, you know, really loved using me in like the rituals, for example, you know, and making me do really violent things there. And, you know, and like I said, like to use me sexually for like his own ends and everything. But he was a little possessive. So there was a lot less of, you know, the overall, just the abuse by like number of people and everything. It was shortly after like we moved there that I had another issue with ritual abuse, you know. And that's one thing I like to let people know, is that I went through what I consider high budget rituals and low budget rituals. So the high budget ones are the ones that I assume all the elites and everything go to, you know, like, and the ones that I've said, they seem like they have caterers or something, you know, the number of costumes and the settings and torches and just, you know, like instruments, like knives and just a number of things that are needed, you know. It's like there obviously is someone organizing this kind of stuff. But when we did that Disneyland trip I had mentioned shortly after my graduation ritual in Washington DC, my dad, we had stopped at the town my dad grew up in, essentially, and he had taken the time to take me to be abused by his younger brother, my uncle. And during that time, he was bragging about all the things that he had been getting involved in, you know, like his the whole point of him abusing me with his brother was that like he was just so excited to just show him like all the sexual skills that I had, essentially, you know, and that it was apparent to me that they had abused people together before, but bragged to him about all that stuff and ritual stuff. So once I moved to Arizona, my aunt and uncle also started using me for what I consider low budget rituals. So like he had a band, you know, that was a little well known, like in like the 90s, and ended up doing, you know, with her help and with my aunt's help, his partner, you know, ended up doing a sacrifice ritual as well. Like shortly after I had moved there, you know, they took an opportunity for me to stay the night at their house after a barbecue, and then went with him and his bandmates, and her, and she had essentially like gone and got what she said was a baby from Mexico, you know, like most of the places I've lived are like on Mexican borders. So I think that's why a lot of like the like more throwaway sacrifice kids that I've seen or have been Mexican, you know. And this one was particularly hard for me, just because like the baby to me seemed like it was already dying, you know, when she had it. So I don't know if it was like, if it could have been drugged, you know, but it was definitely seemed really like weak and like malnourished and stuff like that, you know. And it was, you know, for that just being driven out into the woods and them finding a big rock, you know, and building a bonfire next to it, you know, and then doing, you know, essentially there was no structure to it. It was just getting drunk, you know, and, you know, trying to work up the courage, I think, to do the things that they, you know, that they were trying to do. And it was a ritual for the success of the band and for her to get pregnant, you know, and stuff like that, you know. And it involved bestiality with his dog, and you know, and essentially like my uncle being the one to have, you know, to, they just wanted me to do the dirty work basically, because they had known what I had been used for essentially, but they also like didn't know how to trigger all the right parts, you know? So it's like they essentially were putting me in a situation where they were trying to get me to do something. And there was a lot of resistance like from me to do it. But there was also on my aunt's part, an understanding that my uncle, if he wanted to like be, you know, get the power from it, that he had to be participate in it, you know? So as far as like a sacrifice goes, this one was like the fastest because it seemed like he didn't get enjoyment out of it. It was just like a functional thing, but it was still was not like, it was still the worst thing, you know, you can imagine, you know. And to me though, it really is like the look of the baby is the thing that I have the most difficulty with that stuff, is just knowing like how hard of a life, you know, and how much love, you know, it felt like he had never gotten, you know. And that's the thing to me that is very like, it's just really difficult, you know. And like why I have to talk about this stuff, because it feels like there's so many victims that have just are never going to have a voice, you know, for the things that they had to endure, you know. So for me, you know, I was continued to, you know, to be used for the ritual stuff there. In sixth grade, you know, I was trafficked to the mayor of Tucson. There was like a big cavern that was like, that had a big grand opening. It's with a lot of these things in my experience, it's like there's like a mainstream event and then there's like the private one essentially. So it was, you know, being showing up to this like cavern site before it's open to the public, being trafficked to the mayor of Tucson, him actually being very violent and them having to actually like step in and be like, hey, like she's not a throwaway person basically, and him having to like take it down some. But I think that's where a lot of like the occult kind of stuff comes in, because he was being very verbally abusive about me being dirty, being a whore. I mean, when you're talking about sixth grader, like what the fuck, you know? But you know, all this different stuff. And later on in the ritual, that was the role that I was going to play, was like the role of like the whore. Basically there was like the virgin, which was a younger girl than me, that was brought there by her dad and then essentially raped. And then there was, you know, myself who played the role of the whore. And then there was a high priestess for this situation. So for this one, actually, I do have the photos.
Which one was it labeled?
This would be cavern ritual.
Cavern ritual. Okay, one second.
Let's see the second one.
Real quick. Cavern. All right, here we go. Share.
Awesome. And I'll just let people know too, like the reason I started doing the watercolor journaling is really because like it felt like I could get the scene in my head out the fastest. And then we could spend more time internally for those parts processing the emotions and spending less time with that part trying to really like describe all the details of the scene. And you'll see that most of the time they are from, sometimes you will see them from like a first person perspective, but most of the time they're going to be from like a distance perspective, because it is really like, it's either like an out of body experience, or it's the kind of thing where literally it's just, that's just the part just giving me, I don't know how to describe it. It's very automatic, you know, just giving me like essentially like the scene. So this was essentially like a trailer out back behind the main visitor center, where they had been doing construction and different stuff, you know. So it was almost like, you know, like a spot that had like a kitchen and like a little like a bathroom and like a little like living room type area for people like to use like break room status and everything. So it was being introduced, my dad being introduced by his boss, who was a hand surgeon that was well known in the area, to the mayor, you know, like them talking. I'm sitting on the couch between the two of them, and the mayor is in the blue on the couch there. But that essentially, you know, them talking to him, being a very normal interaction, you know, until they leave, you know. And then it was him essentially berating me, attacking me, them having to come in and tell him to chill out. And then, you know, him essentially like telling me to go get him a drink. And then when I turned around, he ended up attacking me and raping me again. But a lot of it, like I said, was about kind of reinforcing this idea that I was like, a whore, you know, or the whore, you know, because the archetypally that was my role for the upcoming ritual. So the next one is like the scene from like inside the cavern. So there was a high priestess who was nude and had like a big feather headdress. She's not in this one. If you want to go to the next one with the, yeah, there you go. So for this ritual, it was pretty much like just a sex ritual. So there wasn't any sacrifice involved as far as I remember, but I was also drugged for this one. Like it, when my dad came in after to the trailer, after I'd been raped by the mayor, he gave me a glass of water and told me to ask if I wasn't feeling well and if I just needed to lay down and take a nap, you know, and I did. And then essentially woke up in a very, you know, very woozy drug state. And a lot of this stuff was very blurry too, because I wore glasses, you know, most of the time. And I was like taken out like without glasses. So essentially I left that trailer, completely nude except for wearing like a white robe, and was led into like a cavern area. I had to be half carried because I was having trouble with the drugging and walking myself, where there was almost like an amphitheater type space, you know, that was in the cavern, what you're seeing is like a low altar. It's like, it was only maybe about like maybe 8 inches high or something, you know. It was like a low platform that had like red cloth, you know, and gold, like little cross on it. And then there was like 6 men in red robes that were performing the ritual. And then that was being led by like a high priestess who wasn't there. So for this one, you know, it was initially 2 men raping a little girl, you know, the virgin, then it was 2 men. And one of them was the mayor again, raping me, basically. And then it was, the last 2 men that were actually, they performed like more of like a sexual worship, I guess, of the priestess, like, for that particular one. But in general, I didn't have as many trafficking instances like this. Like I said, it was more when it seemed more like when Smeagol decided to share me with someone, you know, than it was anything else. And most of like the trafficking instances were more me playing, like I said, the role of butcher and stuff, stuff like that. So I think the next slide there is just, you know, it might be graphic, you know, for some people, but yeah, it's essentially like how, you know, how the whole scene, you know, played out with like each person being, you know, essentially like raped by two individuals. That's kind of like the whatchamacallit. And I think we're good on the photos now, but that's kind of like the repetitive nature that like that this kind of stuff would have. Like it wasn't super often because my mom was a stay-at-home mom at that point, but it was something that, you know, that happened fairly regularly up until college, you know. And that's like, that's the thing that's difficult to explain to people, is that, you know, up until college, there were still times, you know, where I was literally being triggered, you know, out in public by my abusers and stuff, and then being, you know, essentially like picked up. And that was either a night, because like I said, I was out, you know, in college, I was out doing a lot of, you know, a lot of partying and stuff like that. A lot of times it was just someone finding me at the bar or the party, and you just leave with them, you know, and friends are just like, well, okay, just, you know, just Carrie being wild Carrie, you know what I mean? But not knowing that I'm going to a ritual event or something like that, you know, or even times like where it was very set up, you know, to like for me to get a flat tire on my bike, you know, and then to have them pull up in a car to offer me a ride. And then it's when I refuse, you know, for trigger words to be used, for example, you know. So so I know that's a lot. Do you have any like questions or anything?
Thank you so much.
And then your the artist recall stuff, I think, is the, oh, sorry.
It's so impactful to hear, you know, or I should say to see photos that go along with what you're saying. It creates such a different internalized experience of understanding for this. So I really appreciate you showing that. And it's amazing that you're just the power in our minds, how we're able to extract information sometimes better with our hands than we are in another way, you know? I love that you found different ways to be able to do that, because not everybody's going to have the same experience of how they're healing. And I always love like giving people tools. Like if nothing else works, like try this, you know, try drawing it out. It might not work, but it's another tool, you know, and you had success doing it. And I think it's interesting how you saw it. Like some people feel things, some people will hear stuff, you know, you had like a powerful visual that you could easily, you know, draw out and then construct the story, like reverse engineer it from there and be like, all right, what am I looking at?
And I for think sure, for sure. And that's typically like what, like how a lot of my journaling has been directed is like, it really like, it's, I don't know how to describe it. It's like the part that is sharing just wants what it wants, you know? And that like, when I had the ritual abuse memories and all the violence memories coming up, it felt like, because there was so much like blood involved, really, you know, and different kinds of stuff like that, that it's like, it felt like, you know, doing things with pen or different stuff, it never really did it justice to get, you know, on paper, like what we had seen. Cause obviously, you know, I have way more graphic, you know, things. And a lot of times the things I have to journal are like the most difficult parts for them to feel like less, to take them down to a less intense level, you know? So, I mean, and those things, like, I don't think I'll share with many people because I doubt anyone would want to see it unless, unless you're a fucking psychopath or something, you know what I mean? So maybe for another day, you know, just so that people can really, I mean, if they really want to internalize like what this shit is. But in my experience, like when survivors put out more graphic survivor art, it seems to be like the abusers that collect it. So, yeah.
That's a good point.
That's all I'll say, you know. So that's kind of part of why I was like, oh, like, do I want to put this out, you know? So but those things that do describe the scene, I think are important just to show people, you know, just the reality of like of what we're dealing with, you know. So I mean the last thing that I
okay. Are you able to say who the mayor was at that time? If not, I mean, people could probably go look it up. It's, you know, public records, but I was
So I'm torn about it, because the thing is, if people were to just look at the year and look at the mayor, it's going to give you the wrong person, basically. So and he's deceased, essentially too. But he was his name's George Miller, and he was essentially. So if people look at the year, it says that it's the next mayor coming in, but he was like, it was during the transition time, basically, where he was still mayor and the new guy hadn't officially taken over power. So he was on his way out. But yeah, so I mean, that's one, you know, and the only reason I'm mentioning his name was, like I said, is because he's deceased. All my other abusers, as far as I'm aware, are still alive and kicking, unfortunately. So, you know, one day they'll see the justice they need. I don't wish any harm on anyone, but at the same time, when it comes to people like this, I recognize that they're not going to stop on their own. So, you know, and there's a lot of people out there that need to be protected. So, you know, like one day we're going to get the justice we need, you know, and sometimes it is even in their own lives by their own karma, because they have drinking problems. They have all the other things, you know, that tends to, you know, have them, you know, ship out sooner than the rest of us, luckily. So I guess like the kind of like last thing in like my timeline that I had kind of wanted to go over a little bit was just the recall event type things. And when it comes to the recall events, like that's the thing, like, you know, for most survivors is the hardest thing to kind of wrap your head around. You know, for me it was, for sure, just because it was this belief, you know, that I had not had experience in my adult life, you know, with these people at all. But there are a lot of survivors of trafficking and, like, you know, these more like, you know, more intense, like mind control style events, you know, where they're really trying to create something out of you, essentially, that, you know, have experienced what they call like recall events, where essentially it's almost like them, you know, your abusers, the abuser network, picking you up later on in life to see, to essentially trigger you, you know, into the different parts, the different altars that they've created, and reinforce all the programming that they put in, you know. And for me, my hunch is, you know, when I look at like my age and everything, my hunch really is, I was 26, you know, my hunch really is that like, that it's, at least when I look at it in my life, that it's something that they're trying to do to like head up when they know that your brain chemical changes are typically happening and stuff like that. When those dissociative barriers are going to start coming down, you know, that it's almost like, at least for me, that's how it felt, is it almost felt like it was an opportunity for them to essentially see if they could trigger those parts still, see if they could, if they were all still like reinforced in the negative beliefs that they have, you know, that our abusers are all powerful, that, you know, that we could never talk, you know, all the things that reinforce us not healing, not talking, you know, about what happened, all of that stuff, you know. So for me, it was with my experience, you know, like with my aunt and uncle getting involved in like the ritual abuse stuff, like I have a feeling that my aunt became more involved in the organization herself, you know, through like my dad and stuff as well, just because her daughter, who's about 10 years younger than me, was also trafficked to the organization as well. And I think like this recall event was essentially set up, it was a pretext set up, you know, by her for a vacation that then essentially put me right back in the clutches of like of Schmiegel essentially, and someone he had there as like his assistant. But essentially it was presented to me as like a cruise that was going to be going on with my aunt, my cousin, and then her friend. It was to leave out of Florida. So I was tacked on to the group, I guess, at the end of the of everything. So I ended up getting a separate flight from everyone else. So for my recall event to describe, you know, like what it looked like, you know, it was essentially arriving at the airport in Florida. And as I got off the plane, there was a man just in typical tourist clothes that essentially like I made eye contact with. And he did like, you know, a weird like kind of hand motion with like his two hands, basically. And at the time, you know, this is before I was healing and everything, like with most people with DDNOS, you know, we tend to have like a very, you know, mask like shell like front personality that's like exactly what our abusers want. So I had no ability to like recognize abusers at all. Like I was just always easy. I didn't have anger. I didn't have sadness. I was very dissociated from those emotions, and everything was just like, I was kind of an airhead. Like I don't know how to put it, you know, like very like, you know, what an abuser wants, you know, someone that has no intuition is just going to let them walk all over them, you know? So, you know, and especially, you know, then it's like, you know, oh, a guy, you know, makes eye contact and smiles, you know, and yeah, he gave like weird hand movement, but it's weird with this kind of stuff. It's almost like you see it, but then you immediately like discount it, you know? It was just like, oh, well, that was like weird, like on to the next thing, you know, I'm walking through the airport, finding my spot, you know? So it's like, well, that was weird, but whatever, you know, get on the shuttle, show up at the hotel, like where I was going to be meeting up with my aunt and everyone. And essentially Schmiegel was there. But I knew I kind of recognized him because he made eye contact with me and smiled. So I walked up to him, but I didn't, at that time, I didn't have my memories entirely of all the stuff that I had gone through as a kid, you know, other than knowing that he was somewhat familiar. It's like, it was just this feeling of like walking up to him and him just being plain clothes. He's an older man, you know, he's probably like 60 some, you know, or early 70s at that point. Walking up to him, you know, and because it's like instinctual, I don't know how to describe it. It's like, you know, it's like that one part of you recognizes it. So it's like, as soon as I make eye contact and he smiled, you know, it's like, I walked up to him and he went to shake my hand and then kind of pulled me in for an embrace and said like, kind of like a little weird phrase essentially in my ear. And, I was like, you know, and it's the kind of the same thing where it's like, you like let go of him. And then it's like almost immediately I'd forgotten that interaction had happened. I was just like, almost like, oh, that was weird. And then I just like moved on to like walking to the front desk to find out where my aunt was. But the hand signal and the verbal signal kind of combined essentially created like a dissociative switch in me after I had gone to sleep for the night. So I went to bed like normal, but with that trigger, like I would have a part, you know, the sex assassin part that Schmiegel had created. She was kind of like a madame for the other sexual parts in the system. So would call out the sexual parts that were needed depending on the situation and everything, but had a more of, you know, an abuser kind of role because of that, you know, very Ghislaine Maxwell, you know? So essentially, you know, her job, you know, was to, once we went to bed after midnight, to then leave the room, exit the room. So we exit the room, and outside the room is the younger of the two men. I just call him, you know, Smeagol's assistant. And he's waiting there for me to escort me like onto the elevator and into a different room where Smeagol was waiting. And it was seeing him. And he liked when, for that sex part, it was to call him daddy, basically. That was his like many abusers, their preferred choice of term, I guess, you know? And so, you know, it was immediate recognition, like, oh, hi daddy, you know, and being essentially given a pill. Cause like I said, that's what he liked, you know, is he liked me being not all there, and everything, and some lingerie essentially to go get changed, you know, while he set up the cameras with his other guy. And essentially for that night, it was calling out, you know, different sex parts, where the whole point was because I was in a loving relationship with like my partner, who's I've been together with like 11 years, and he's like, you know, he's one of the main reasons I've like healed is because he's just so loving and supportive and amazing. He's just the best father that like anyone could ever imagine. But you know, I had a really strong relationship with him, was in love with him, you know, and everything. So a lot of that initial night was about blackmail, was sexually humiliating me, like making me do like a lot of things, you know, or doing a lot of things like to me, like that were, and a lot of it too was because they were pulling out, you know, like the child sex altars and stuff like that, is like a lot of like performance on my part that would be very humiliating, you know, if it were to come out, especially my partner would just see it like with other people and everything like that, you know. So that really was kind of like the thing that kind of set the tone, you know. It was almost like it was like the blackmail that was for my current self was like the thing to start everything. And then there were three nights after that that were on the cruise itself that I had the same thing happened, you know, where I would be triggered and then I would leave my room after the night, after I had gone to bed, and then go up to their room, and then more programming would take place. So like the first night, you know, was mostly about being gagged, and mostly being about like physical torture, you know, so like, you know, shocking, the pinprick stuff all over again, some like VR kind of stuff, you know, where they're showing you really horrific things like on, you know, headset type stuff, or, you know, at least being told, and I still am skeptical about this, you know, but at least being told that I had like a chip, you know, that had been implanted. So they would always know, you know, what was going on with me, or that they would be able to control me or stuff. And like I said, like this stuff is hard for me to like give real seriousness too, because so much of this program you're dealing with, it sounds so big and scary, but it really is just like, it's really just like you can tell kids anything to confuse them and, you know, to convince them of shit. So for me, it's like even having a memory of a chip being inserted and stuff, it's like it could literally be nothing, and it's just them telling you that something's there that's going to keep that level of fear and, oh, like I can't escape, you know, type of thing. So, you know, so there was a lot of that, you know. The second night was to call out all the cult allied parts that, you know, that Smeagol had done. So, and making us, you know, doing a real fancy late night dinner, you know, and just essentially that night didn't have as much trauma to it. It was more like reinforcing the reason why we wanted to be part of the cult, you know, and, you know, and my cousin being there at like that fancy dinner too. So she was also being trafficked to some guys there, you know. The whole dinner, you know, was people that were in the know, you know, so there was obviously other people on the cruise that were all like part of the same thing, you know, basically. And a lot of the thing on the cruise too was about me essentially signing documents, you know, at that night being, you know, wined and dined and then presented with documents where I was essentially like, you know, legally signing over and agreeing to everything that they said, including like ownership over my children or something, you know, like any future kids that I have, you know, we're gonna belong to them and all kinds of stuff, you know, like that. So and that for that part of you that's 100% allied, it's like that part of you has no feeling towards kids or anything. Like that part of you is the person, that evil queen that they wanted to create, you know, at that point. So for that person, it's like, you, I don't have attachment to kids. Why would I have any problem signing this document, you know? But to look back on that as a mother, you know, and to see like how much they can manipulate someone to be at that point, you know, it's just sickening, you know, and heartbreaking, you know? And the last night of the cruise, you know, was there to essentially call out, you know, my more sexual sadistic alter, you know, to abuse my cousin who was underage at the time, you know. So that's part of like why I was bringing stuff up, is that with all this blackmail stuff, you know, that's what it is. It's blackmail, you know. And if any of these things were to come out, you know, like especially because I was over 18 when these dissociative parts were being exploited, you know, it's like if there was no context for this kind of stuff, you know, it's like, you know, I would hate me too, you know. Like so it's like it's understanding completely, you know, that like, you know, I don't know, a lot of it is trying to take away the powers of the manipulation and everything, you know. So that was one part, you know, of the recall event. And then the second part of the recall event, which I consider it the second part, even though it was like, you know, over a year later, was essentially a trafficking event where I had gone to Paris with my mom, and same situation. I had started to be triggered while we had arrived in the airport and started feeling really violently ill kind of because of it. Like I have a feeling at that point my triggers weren't working quite as well, because there was multiple times where I was getting the hand signal, like on the trip that I was seeing, like on the at the Musée d'Orsay and stuff, but eventually, you know, I had seen the hand signal several times. And then once we were at like a fancy dinner for my mom's birthday, I was down in, you know, all the basements or all the bathrooms in Paris are in basements, basically. So even this swanky ass spot that we were at had a basement bathroom. So I went down to town to this swanky basement, you know, to use their bathroom. And Schmiegel was there, you know, to essentially, you know, see me as I came out of the bathroom and give me the verbal signal. So what we see here on the screen is essentially the bottom left-hand corner is just me, you know, leaving the hotel, like at, you know, in the middle of the night, you know. And literally at that point, it's like for anyone, even the front desk people, it's like it literally would have been me, you know, of my own accord, walking out of the room, walking past, you know, they probably would be assuming that I'm having a cigarette or something like that, you know, just walking out the lobby, waving, you know, like waving to the people in the lobby, you know, like, oh, like, have a great night. Okay, cool. Thanks. You know what I mean? Like, you know, and just going out and there being essentially like a guy waiting to open the door for a black limo for me. And I got into the back and Schmiegel was there waiting. And he, you know, he essentially was kind of finished doing some things to kind of like ensure the right part was out, including sexually abuse me. And then I was brought to this French man's apartment, basically, who I had been trafficked to, and he was hosting a cocktail party that was a pre-ritual cocktail party. So a lot of that event, you know, was just me, you know, that's the bottom right-hand corner, is just me hanging out with the French man, the man I had been trafficked to. Remembering conversation of like how fucked up it was that it's like, you know, there's a certain level of like them sharing their slaves with each other too, that just feels like, you know, like it's they're living vicariously through their slaves' abilities or something, you know. So it was just like him, you know, Schmiegel giving me to this guy, and just it feeling like it was all for Schmiegel to feel like more cool or more powerful, you know, or whatever, because he had gotten this guy like the perfect sex kit, you know. And that's like what, you know, they had talked about, you know, was just that, you know, this French man had been looking forward to meeting me because I was more like European sex kittens as opposed to American ones, because I wasn't just like I wasn't just the Marilyn Monroe, you know, I wasn't just, I had like the art stuff, and I was always, you know, like said, gate program and everything. I was always very academically advanced, you know, and that kind of stuff, you know, and then not to mention, you know, the, like the occult kind of skills, all that stuff for them was just something that just made me a more fascinating sex kitten, a more, you know, and he just was so intrigued that I was like an American sex kitten that, you know, had more to me, you know, I guess, you know, which is fucked up, you know. So that was most of that, you know, cocktail night. And then all these people essentially all got into cars and then drove to essentially what was like, it looked like, you know, like a church or government type building type thing that had like an entryway underneath it to like some catacombs. And that's what you're seeing as like the top part. So it was essentially a ritual space that was underneath Paris. It had like, there was some natural features to the rock, but a lot of it was more like, it was flat walls with like, you know, the little square, I don't know, like drawers that they put people in. I don't know, there was like, you know, it's a grave site, you know, basically, you know, so there's like some carved pillars, you know, and, you know, wrought iron, like candelabras and stuff like that. But the whole thing was like a sepulcher. Had like, you know, there was obviously like bodies like in the walls and everything. And there, you know, there was another high priestess, you know, and the people that were performing the ritual were also in red. I was like dressed before that in like literally just like an executioner hood. It was like nude and with like kind of a gold belt and dangly thing. And then just like essentially a red executioner hood that like, you know, fully concealed like my face and everything. And you know, and for that one, it was, you know, it was that one's tough too, because it's like, you know, different age ranges, you know, it's like babies, they don't have as much awareness, you know, but she was like more like a toddler. She was more like two or so, you know, like two or three, you know, it was a little girl, you know, victim that had been essentially, you know, was sexually abused. And then after that, it was essentially my job to go and, you know, to help with the people that were then like, you know, draining their blood and like catching it in like, you know, in a basin to then be distributed for like a black mass type thing. And then my main role was that was like a butchery part, which was essentially that, like, it was had the whole thing had like a black mass kind of feel to it. So the communion would have, you know, was the blood that was like served, you know, out of like these like silver chalices. And then there was, for like, I guess the communion, it was like the digits of like the fingers and toes that it's like I had to like separate essentially, like, and then, you know, that's what, you know, cannibalism style, that was like what was like served for the, like their black mass. So that's the next slide there, you know, would be what you're seeing there, which is essentially, you know, the high priestess standing behind me, like, and me with the little girl, essentially, like, she's already deceased there, you know, but essentially like doing some dismemberment so that the line of people that's waiting there that have been witnessing the ritual can like essentially, you know, come up and partake in the cannibalism aspect of things. So as far as I'm aware, it's hard when you're dealing with dissociative stuff. This is like the last time that I had any interaction with these people, you know. I had a big lag in college prior to this recall event because I essentially was my programming was breaking down, and I was just kind of like in self-destruct mode and had kind of decided was just really being really promiscuous, you know, like other than what the cult, you know, and Schmiegel had wanted, you know. So after several instances during college of trying to like pick me up and like really like reinforce the humiliation and different stuff to try and get me to like not be so going so crazy, essentially, like, it's like he just kind of like he lost interest with me, basically, you know. It's like they're only interested in people they can really control, you know. And I like at a certain point I got to the point, you know, where I was in self-destruct mode. So that's just why, that was part of why, you know. And there was a lot of things that he did to make me cut myself, doing a lot of things, you know, to try and like reinforce, you know, like putting that stuff back in a box, because essentially, you know, he just wanted to have control over who he didn't want me, you know, sleeping with who I wanted to sleep with. He only wanted me to sleep with who he wanted, you know, essentially. So until the recall event, you know, and then after that, it was probably maybe a year after the Paris event that I really started, like, you know, I had been breaking down for years, you know, during like the heavy ritual time, like October through December, consistently. It would just be every year I would go through the deepest like depression and just like, you know, really be ready to give up on everything, you know. And that's kind of where I was at, you know, after like the Paris stuff. You know, it's like you have all the flashbacks coming up, all the emotions and different stuff, and not having like the context for it. You know, I was really in a place ready to like to give up, you know. But that's also why I'm like grateful, is when we hit our bottoms, you know, is when we like is when we have the opportunity to go the other direction, you know. And as much as I was ready to like give up when it came to just dealing with like the mental health struggle and the PTSD symptoms, like my whole life, and, you know, it was my empathy and the fact that it's like I had loved ones in my life and I couldn't do that to them, you know, that made me start to like really work on myself and heal, you know. And from that, you know, came some of the roughest years of my life, you know, because when you choose to look at things you've put in a box for so long, you know, it does sometimes feel like it gets rougher before it gets better. But that's the thing I always come back to people, is that it's worth it, you know, that the number of phobias, triggers, just everything that I used to have, you know, prior to dealing with these, with all this stuff from my past, you know, was infinite, you know. And the number now, it's like it feels like a handful. So it's like the way that it can really give you ownership of your life again, to not feeling, you know, not feeling like a slave, feeling completely empowered. And, you know, and now getting to the point where I can see, you know, I can see Smeagol and the way he looks nowadays in his 80s with his giant alcoholic nose, and just know that if I were to like see him on the street, that at this point he would be the one afraid, not me, you know. He would be the one like, oh shit. You know, and that to me is like, you know, it's a feeling that I can't, like, I really can't, like, you know, it's worth more than the world. Feel like I can protect myself, protect my son, you know, and that, you know, to really feel like these motherfuckers don't have any power over me, you know, that's, you know, it really is the best feeling in the world. I think the only thing I didn't go over, you know, in regards to stuff, if you do want to get into it, or, you know, we can always talk about it at another time, was just the New World Order aspect of things, you know, like I said, that I kind of feel bad, because I kind of laugh a little bit when I talk about the New World Order stuff, because it's kind of hard for me to understand, like, especially knowing how fucked up their timeline is. Their timeline, yes, is like how much of this stuff was ever going to happen, and how much of it was literally just like delusions of grandeur with like psychopaths. Because it's like, you're going to tell your slaves a lot of things, you know, and they're going to believe them because we're kids, you know what I mean? But it's like, it's so consistent with survivors to be talking about, you know, even in my own life, that was a lot of what broke that programming, was to realize like, oh, like, I'm like way older than I was supposed to be for the roles that they gave me, you know, like I've already, like, my expiration date was 35 and I just turned 35 last month. So even that, like, was for me, was like, you know, was that I was told that I was given, most slaves had a 30-year-old expiration date, but I was special because I was given that extra 5 years because I had other roles, you know, other than just sex kitten stuff, you know. But to know that even that is like, oh, like, that was supposed to happen when I was in my 20s, you know, and like, you know, and, you know, here we are now. It's like, I'm still living my life, and, you know, and like I've never been picked up, you know, and enslaved again, you know. It's a beautiful thing when you start realizing like how much, you know, there is a lot of very real stuff to be worried about when it comes to psychopaths, but there's also a lot of stuff that's just total bullshit, you know.
Well, and talking too about, you know, you made a good point, just these illusions of grandeur, almost like they try to be so clever, and like if what they did wasn't so horrifying, it would almost be funny the effort that they put into some of the stuff. Like whenever you were going over that ritual when your savior came in on his white horse,
yeah,
like I was in that moment thinking about it from your child's eye, but then afterwards I had a flash of, that is so silly that adults get together and like they literally got a white horse from somewhere. shoot up like he was Fabio. They
up like, and it's like in his mind, he's like, it's an experience for him that he's like, I don't know. It's like this whole like facade that's set up for him to be. Yeah. It's like
all
what?
That effort to like make a 5-year-old feel like she's
indebted to you. Yeah.
It is just so bizarre just to think about, you know, actual grown adults who are probably respected in their community, probably have a lot of money, a lot of resources, like literally sitting in a room like, all right, who's got the horse? Like, who's going to go get the horse? You know, where can I get a horse from? Who's got my white outfit? Who's going to do my hair? It's like, it sounds crazy because it is like, these are literal crazy people doing actual crazy things. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it is like, it's so bizarre to think about being a part of this world and how much detail and thought goes into everything that they do. But also like, if you take out anything else, like if you just look at like the overview of like what they're planning, like how incredibly like silly most of it is, you know what I mean? It's just so hard to even fathom, but I completely agree with you.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's really how I feel about it too, is like initially when you're dealing with flashbacks coming up initially, it's like, you're going to be dealing with like, you know, like you really do feel like everyone says, you know, like it's happening in that moment. So that level of belief that you had in that moment of like fear of like whatever powers or abilities they had or whatever like plan for the future or whatever role or whatever, you know, it really is. It's like, we come back to, you know, it's like for that part, like those times of trauma are their whole world. They don't have they don't have like normal life to draw on to be like, oh, like things are going to be like, you know, I'm going to have, you know, lunch later this day, you know, or a different, you know what I mean? To just know that all that stuff, you know, so for those parts, yeah, it's like, it's so easy to convince them of like a crazy worldview and for them to just be like 100% bought into it, you know? And like I said, I'm not like discounting some reality to this shit, because the thing is, I do believe they are trying to really do all these things that they talk about when it comes to like the more new world order plan type of stuff. Like, yeah, they're psychopaths. There's obviously a desire for world domination. Like, why wouldn't there? That's the name of the game for them, you know, is to dominate, control, all that kind of stuff, you know? So, you know, so for sure, you know, it's like, it's, I would understand that. I don't know, that almost to me, it's like these belief systems or like the new world order shit would almost naturally arise, you know, out of like a psychopathic community of people, you know, but that's where I'm at, is like understanding that that's a reality versus understanding the reality to which it's like actually going to be enacted, you know, to me, like that's where I don't have very much fear and stuff like that. Cause I do feel like, you know, I don't know. It's like as fast as like they're trying to put people asleep, people are waking up faster, you know? And even in my life, like when I look at like the fact, like when I was first healing, like 6 years ago and 7 years ago, and talking about like Epstein to people and everything, and everyone just looking at me like I was crazy, you know, like, people don't do that, you know? And I was just like, and then to be like 2 or 3 years later, and then all of a sudden it's like the same people that were like, that doesn't exist, to be like, oh, did you hear Epstein killed himself? And I'm like, yeah. I mean, I like, yeah, everything you're telling me I've known for like 5, 6 years, but it's just because people don't, you know, they don't really want to look into it, which I don't blame them on a certain level, because it's like, you know, who is going to choose to look at these things, you know, unless you're forced to, you know? So I completely understand that. And the thing is too, is when you're dealing with things that are so delusional grandeur style, when it comes to New World Order stuff, it is easy for people on the outside that don't believe it, psychopaths, to just hear that Illuminati shit or something and just be like, that's stupid. That's just some Hollywood shit. How could anyone ever think that they would do that? You know what I mean? Like, and so, yeah, so it's understandable, you know? Would you like me to go at all into the role that I was supposed to have for the NWO? Okay. Okay, cool. So there was a couple, there's two, actually. So one of them was that I had been, essentially because of the problem solving abilities and stuff like that, like I, and the wolf altar that had been created, and all of that training about like the motivation that was given to us was essentially that it was part of like the New World Order agenda, is that the role that I was given was called hunter tracker, basically. And that essentially I was chosen because of, you know, like my problem solving, my attention to detail, intelligence was a lot of it. Like, so a lot of like me and the other packmates was about like that you were going to have slaves that had to be supervised, and you were going to have slaves that were essentially trusted and allowed to like go out and be on their own and enact stuff, you know, a lot more and make more of their own decisions, essentially, you know, in service of the cause. So for my role, it was basically that I was going to be called on, and people, you know, that had the same role, the hunter tracker type stuff. It was mostly guys. That was part of one thing that was also impressed upon me, was that I was special because I was like a girl that was doing this kind of stuff, you know, that, you know, but it was also one reason it was seen as a huge asset, basically, was that I was a female. So, so for me, like what I was instructed is the, you know, the whole role was that, you know, the wolf altar at the time that the New World Order had essentially taken over, you know, all of the major populaces and stuff. And there was a large refugee population that was going to be, you know, trying to be on the run and everything. The hunter trackers were meant to essentially be going out and tracking down those people. The goal was that you were going to be killing any adults that were refugees, because they've already proved that they're not, you know, usable essentially for their agenda. So they just wanted to dispose of them. Then any kids that the refugees had were supposed to be essentially like taken by me or whoever, you know, whoever the hunter was, you know, back to our home base, essentially. So for me, it was put to me in like a couple of different ways, that essentially it was, you had the wolf altar come out, you know, that would feel very at home in the woods, you know, so we would be directed to an area to go search, you know, and we would just go out and just live in the woods, basically, just looking for signs of people, essentially, and allowing ourselves to like get fairly dirty and different things like that, because the whole point was that if we were to find a group of three adults or less, then the goal was that I needed to sneak up on them at night and then use my knife to essentially kill them, and then take any kids if they had them. And if not, then I would just go back and just report where the bodies were at, essentially. But things got a lot more complicated if it was more than three people, basically. So if it was more than three people, I was supposed to do one of a few things. So essentially the wolf altar was supposed to take a back seat once we encountered those people. And, you know, my public persona, who's, you know, very charming and friendly and all that kind of stuff, you know, very just normal and innocent seeming, you know, was supposed to come out. But depending on the size of the group, we were supposed to either pretend to be sick, you know, and we were going to just be a lone female coming out of the woods, you know, on this refugee group. We were either supposed to pretend to be sick, you know, or we were literally supposed to injure ourselves, you know, do something like use a rock or a stick or something to like, you know, physically injure ourselves so that we would be more like lame duck, essentially, you know. So we would arrive into refugee camp, you know, we would be taken in as like another wounded refugee, and like essentially there were like parts in the background, the wolf part and then like the sexual assassin part, that were supposed to be assessing the particular group for the personalities that were going on and the leaders, to understand like whether our best in to like becoming part of the group and then advancing as far as status in the group, whether it was going to be through sexual means or whether it was going to be through, like I said, like the problem solving means, like, because I could like, I don't know, I'm good at like inventing and MacGyvering stuff, you know? So it's like, you know, like, oh, we need like this like random thing made out of like sticks and rocks, you know? So it sounds stupid, you know what I mean? But it's the kind of thing that it's like that I've all, you know, they reinforce too. So it's like, they also give you additional stuff, you know, but just in being useful. So being able to like help with like medical stuff or splinting, or being able to help like with, you know, just just normal things that you would need for living in the woods, you know, just kind of stuff like that, you know. Essentially, if you've ever heard of COINTELPRO, how like the FBI's like whole thing was with infiltrating, you know, counterculture groups and stuff, is that, you know, you have your undercover agent that goes in, but because they're technically an agent and they do have way more skills than other people, they're able to like advance very quickly through the ranks of the group, you know, and gain a position of power and trust because of that. You know, people don't suspect, you know, that that's the case. So it was the same with me, you know, is that I was supposed to find my route to getting an in with the group. During that time, I needed to be assessing like the kids, like, so kids that were like in between time, like, so they were like 11, you know, to like, you know, 15 or so, you know, or like, you know, roughly that age where you're looking at like tweens and stuff like that. Those ones were supposed to be like assessed on whether or not they were going to be cooperative and like would, you know, just come back with me, or whether they had to be, when the time came, you know, also killed along with the adults, you know. And that's pretty much what most of it was about, is that, you know, is that there was going to be front persona that was doing all the other stuff, and then the other persona that was essentially making all the plans for, you know, when was going to be the right opportunity to essentially, you know, do what we did, you know, with the other, you know, a smaller group, you know, which would be kill the people we were supposed to kill, and then take, you know, the kids, you know, back essentially to the base, you know, and giving myself time to figure out supplies, you know, all the different things I would need to try and get as many kids back alive as I could, essentially, you know, and, you know, have big kids carrying smaller kids, like all that kind of stuff, you know, was like all the different logistic type of shit, you know, that they went into, you know, with me. And it was stuff that they would reinforce, you know, with programming, like I was saying, like, so like a lot of like the training for knives or weapons or stuff like that, like they create that altar for you like early on, but almost like before you physically can do those things. So then it's like later on, it's like there were instances like where I was at church camp out of town or different things, like where they had opportunities to like, you know, pick me up for a night, you know, or, you know, a little bit at a time, you know, and it's like almost like there would be like additional training added on to those parts, you know, because now we were fit at a physical age where we could actually maneuver and manipulate, you know, these kinds of things, you know, the weapons and everything. So that was one role. And then the other role was supposed to come after this role. So this was after, once everything was like stable with the New World Order in trouble, that there was essentially like people that were chosen to be rulers of the different territories, essentially. So I was introduced shortly after I moved to Tucson by Schmiegel to someone I was presented to was related to him, but so now I wonder if it was, if he wasn't actually related, but was maybe just like a mentorship role. But regardless, you know, he was about 10 years older than myself, you know, like 10 to 15 years older than myself. And he was essentially, for my other role, the role in the cruise that had signed the documents, the, you know, the dark queen royalty type role that was created, was to essentially be a second in command for the guy that had been chosen to be like the king of this territory. So to be his queen, but it's still more, I say queen, but still more like you're like a second in command. Like I said, it's like, you're like that sex kitten bodyguard. You're also, because of like the problem solving stuff, being able to help with like, you know, organization and logistics sides of things, you know, and people management, even being a gizlane to him, to finding his victims, you know, there wasn't any emotional attachment there as like him as us having a relationship, you know, is more, you know, that, you know, that, you know, and, you know, just, and being a breeder, you know, essentially just making kids, you know, with him, you know, and still, even with that role, 35 was the cutoff though. You know, I was expected to play that role until, you know, it seemed like mid 20s, you know, or like, you know, early 20s until I was like 35, and then be, you know, replaced essentially, like was, you know, was the kind of always the understanding with that. So a lot of that, you know, really was just about, you know, just knowing how to be just like a ruthless ruler who just knew what, you know, what to get done, you know, basically. So those were the two roles, you know, that were really specifically for me, like geared towards like, you know, the, like this like New World Order agenda. But like I said, like for me, it's something I kind of almost like laugh at a tiny bit now, just because it's realizing how off the timeline was, you know, and that like, you know, that they, you know, they really expected, you know, whatever was going to happen, you know, this role that they would need for hunting or refugees or something, they expected it was going to happen at least a decade ago, I think, you know, or like, you know, maybe, you know, sooner, earlier than that, who knows, you know, but it's really realizing that's the case at this point makes me feel optimistic that like more and more they're getting, you know, the psychopaths, you know, the pedophiles, everyone's getting exposed. People are understanding that they exist in society and what they do, you know, and I really feel like the likelihood that the agenda is ever going to succeed, you know, I mean, I really, you know, like, thank Buddha, Jesus, higher power, you know, I'm optimistic that, you know, we're heading on the right path, you know, so, but yeah, I feel like that was like forever, so much word vomit. I hope it was helpful to like you and any survivors or anyone who's like an ally. I think that's it's not everything when you think about the number of instances. Of course, it's not everything, you know, sure. But for me, it's at least, you know, the main events that really kind of give like a good arc as far as like for people to understand the number of things that people go through, the different motivations, I guess, a little bit, you know, because it's so hard to understand. And people can know how much child pornography is out there just by volume. But for some reason, it's just like really understanding like where those victims come from and all that stuff still seems to be like a big like mystery to most people, you know, and it's just something I hope can be helpful, you know, it's just sharing my experience about everything that happened and people understanding the motivations, you know, without even, you know, many of your guests have gone into paperclip and stuff like that. So understanding that motivation behind, you know, why they understand the developmental ages and when to do the different traumas and stuff. But it's like, I mean, to me on a certain level, it's like, you know, paperclip or no paperclip, psychopaths are going to still be psychopaths, you know, and this is still going to exist, you know? So, Hopefully we're just knocking down that wall like one little bit at a time.
We are. Oh my goodness. And your testimony gives me so much hope too. You know, seeing younger survivors coming forward, people like you, Gray, there's more and more that are starting to come out. It's like the programming itself is breaking. I feel it'll continue maybe breaking a little bit earlier because there's so many awakened people out there. This information is not so hard to come by now. I mean, it is, but it's becoming easier. You can go type in like mind control in a search and find a million different things on it, you know, or survivors or SRA or ritual abuse, you know, human trafficking. Like their attempt at censoring that information, you know, through controlling the internet doesn't work either. Like it didn't work. It backfired on them. They can go ahead and check it all they want, but our voices are here. They're loud and they're not going anywhere. And we're all connecting. We're all finding each other and we're all getting louder, you know, and there's people like you that are willing to just take a chance and come out and share your testimony. And now you're handing that torch over and there's going to be more people who listen to your story that say, I want to stand up and have a voice too. Carrie inspired me, you know, and the most beautiful.
Even if it's just one person, I would be grateful, you know?
Yes, 100%. And like the most beautiful part about your story is seeing you here today smiling in the place where you have a beautiful career that you love. You have the man of your dreams and a beautiful son. And you're able to sit here and speak in your conviction and with strength and even literally to say, you know, if my perpetrator were to be walking the street, he's going to be scared of me now. Like when you said that like sends chills up my spine, you know, it's just really beautiful to see the healing journeys that you go through and like how inspiring that is for other people on the other side who are struggling. Sorry, I'm going to cry.
Yeah.
You know, just to see like what's on the other side. If you start putting in the work and like connecting and researching, like it's our empowerment. Like you said, it's how you take your power back by learning. Your gifts are beautiful. You had people that abused you because you were gifted, because you were talented, because you were beautiful, because you were a child of God. People took those gifts and exploited them and used them for things that are evil. And you can take that back and take those gifts and recognize that they're your God-given gifts and use them to create something beautiful. Use them to have beautiful relationships. Use them to be a good, loving parent. Use them to create a beautiful business, to draw, to write, to do whatever is in your heart that you didn't get the opportunity to explore as a child because your gifts were being exploited, you know? And that's like, they created and manufactured the world that we're in right now. And the only reason why it exists is because they've convinced us that it's real. And so we believe it. And the way out of it is to create our way out of it. If we all say, what are my gifts that are trying to be stifled, that are trying to be shut up, that people are trying to use or exploit, and say, how do I take that back and create, how do I create the world that I want instead? You know, they can't, as much as they want to copy God and try to be God, they can't. And those gifts are from God within us. That is how we bring God here to the world, is we create what he gave us. We create with the gifts that he gave us, the world that we want. And as soon as we all learn to do that, and by following your example and doing that, that's when we really take our power back. And that's when the world will start to change. You know, we can do this by coming together. And your testimony is such a beautiful example of that. And I hope people listening, you know, I know actually that they're going to be inspired. And I hope that this encourages some people to find that strength that you have and to look at their situation a little bit differently and to want to, you know, use their story instead of letting their story use you. And I just can't thank you for coming on here and sharing, because I know this is, it's horrific just thinking about what you went through, you know, and hearing your stories from your child's mind. Like, it's so sad. But at the same time, I think it makes people care more. And when we can have that empathy, that's when we'll have the courage to take what we're to take those God-given talents and to say, like, okay, I want to serve with them. Like, this is what I'm going to contribute to this world and to this movement and to the children. You know, I'm going to create something and I'm going to have the courage to do it and to stand boldly and know that anybody that tries to mess with me, they better be scared, not me.
Yeah. That's what I said. I said, that's like my thing I said the other day. And I still love, you know, is that I feel like, especially when you look at all the knife crap, you know, that it was just like, damn, like I feel, and I look at and all my strengths, you know, like I said, you know, the art, you know, like the, you know, just the, you know, introspection, just a lot of the stuff, you know, that I just felt like, I was just like, damn, like, I feels like they like honed like a really sharp weapon. And now it's like pointing at them. And, you know, and that's like the point that I am like so grateful to have come to in my therapy, you know, is that, you know, like everything you said is giving me like goosebumps, because that's like, that's how I feel, you know. I have, and it's just so grateful to be, you know, in a place of, you know, I jokingly was in hermit mode the past like 6 years, because I, after a year of healing on the incest, I came out to my family and publicly on Facebook about the abuse, and, you know, all shit hit the fan, you know. But also it was parts of me that felt like we were very vulnerable still to, you know, I still hadn't processed all the emotions, all the memories, and worked through all the lies and everything. So it's like, it was very much still being in this, the past 6 years of my life, being in this point, you know, where I felt like I had to stay small. I had to stay hidden, you know, that if Smeagol were to see me, if like my dad or uncle were to see me, you know, that they would, you know, that they would just smash you down, you know what I mean? Or they would pick you back up and put you back in that fucking cage or something like that, you know? And it was really, it was finally, that's why I really encourage everyone to heal, you know, is when it's one thing to like understand like, oh, like I don't have anything to be given for, or, oh, like, you know what I mean? Intellectually, you know, like, it's one thing to understand things, but as a survivor, you say, like, you have to come to the point where you really believe and feel in your soul, like the things that people are telling you, that you never did anything wrong, that you were a victim, that, you know, all of that stuff, you know. And so for me, that's why I really try and encourage, you know, survivors of, you know, and you don't have to go through something this drastic, you know, like even like small traumas that we go through and can hold on to, they can still negatively affect our lives like forever, you know. And that's where I just feel like, it's just so, you know, the reward is in the process, you know. And to feel, like I said now, like to know that I had years of just hardcore fear when it came to thinking about my abusers, if I see them on the street, if this, that, the other, you know what I mean? Or even thinking like, am I still triggerable, or all that kind of stuff, you know? And then to just get to the point where it's like, it does all sink in, you know, really, that, you know, that you were a kid then, you're an adult now, you know, that these motherfuckers, they only bully kids, you know, and that, you know, you never see them being like this with like adults and stuff like that. And that when you can really internalize that, you know, like, you know, where you're at presently, which is probably a very safe place, you know, and everything, you know, and who that you have in your life and everything like that, then it really does, like, I mean, it takes stuff that was standing in the way of enjoying all of those things and finally just like makes it go away, and all the fear goes away, you know, and not all of it, you know, it's still, you're going to still have to deal with and process stuff, you know, as you know, as life comes about, you know, but regardless, to be in a point where, you know, like, know, essentially, like, really know that, like, you have no responsibility for that shit, and really understand, you know, that, like, that, you know, that like you said, that you're a child of God and a child of light, and all the things that they did to force you to believe that you were evil or worthless or, you know, unlovable by anyone except for them, or all, or like them, you know, all those things that they did, you know, really were just lies that were told to a kid. And it's kind of sad that, like, on the other side of it, it almost feels like silly that I believed those things for so long, you know. And it's very heartbreaking too, to know it stood in the way of me really enjoying the life that I had, you know. But it's why I'm here today, you know, is because this is helping me to, like, continue to feel empowered and continue on my path. I'm hoping it'll help other people to do that, you know, and hopefully it's, like, you know, it's the first of, you know, maybe more instances, you know, that, like, I can, like I said, I was thinking about starting a channel and everything, that I can do some help, you know, with you know, giving some people some insights of just what worked for me, you know, during my healing process to get to this place of, like, gratitude from the place of fear that I had been living in. So, yeah, thank you. I mean, you're doing God's work, you know, just like, I mean, I could not be here unless you had, you know, been here and inspired me for, you know, for a couple years now. So thank you, Emma.
Oh, Carrie, thank you too. It's such an honor to have you on. This is such a special episode and such, I mean, you went into a lot of detail too, that I think is going to help people understand things that maybe they wouldn't have been clear about before. So I know that it's always so hard to talk about all of this. And I appreciate you coming on and taking your time out to talk to us and educate us and to share your story, you know, and it's everything that they don't want, you know? And yeah. I just love that. Like, I love all the ways that you've broke through everything. Like, you shouldn't be here, you know, and here you are speaking your testimony on a public platform. And it just, like, I'm cheering you on, and so is everybody. And I know I speak on behalf of everybody, like, please start a channel. Like, we would all love that. I'll help you if I can. I'm really excited for that. You're made for this.
Yeah. No, thank you. It's from being an AA for over a decade, you know, it really feels like part of my healing has always been, like, trying to, like, whatever I have, trying to give it away. It just, you know, even from a selfish standpoint, it just helps really it sink in for yourself, you know, too. So that's where I'm at, you know, with this is, like, I've talked to so many people about healing and about, you know, about sexual abuse in their past and different stuff like that, and being able to, like, help them with, like, some guidance on, like, dealing with the stuff and everything. But, you know, I mean, just when it comes to very, like, nuts and bolts things like journaling tips and stuff like that, I do feel like, it's really, it sounds crazy, but it's, like, when it comes to the trauma healing, in my experience, it really is. It's like, it's the simple things that you make a habit of that really do make the long-term difference, you know? And I feel like sometimes when you're in that, like, especially if you're new to dealing with, like, your flashbacks and all that kind of stuff, it's easy to get overwhelmed. So I think that, like, it would be really helpful to sometimes have little steps, you know, concrete things that was really helpful for me to just feel like I was making some progress and not just, like, disappearing into, like, this, like, you know, ocean of shit.
100%. Yes, that would be amazing. And again, thank you so much for coming on. Do you have any closing thoughts before we start wrapping up?
No, I don't think so. Other than, you know, just like to reiterate, you know, if you're on your healing path, stay on it, you know, like, look for, you know, resources like Emma. I have, like, other resources, like a book by Allison Miller that I would really recommend. I don't know. It's called Becoming Yourself, Healing from Ritual Abuse and Mind Control, by Allison Miller. I think it's a really wonderful book that, you know, just if you think that what you're dealing with is, you know, like, more structured programming type of stuff, I feel like it fills in a lot of the gaps that regular DID stuff research kind of misses, essentially. And then the one other resource I would love people to look up is a therapist named John Uller. He has like a YouTube, and has been on, but I would just recommend looking him up and listening to some podcasts that he's been on. Most of what he talks about is understanding psychopathy, so understanding the abusers. And in my opinion, that was a huge factor into me taking a lot of the responsibility and guilt and ownership off of my actions. Was once I could really understand the way a psychopath's brain worked, their motivations, all that stuff, I could really see the manipulation for what it was. So that's the only other, for survivors, those are the two resources. And his name is spelled J-O-N and U-H-L-E-R. So either of those I would definitely recommend. They were really helpful, for me, among other things. I just wish everyone stays safe and blessed and everything out there, and just on their journey moving towards the light, because that's where we all belong.
Thank you so much for that. That's so encouraging, and what a beautiful note to leave off on. And we all wish the same for you, Carrie. So I ask everybody, please send all your love, send all your prayers, send all your light, all your healing energy, all of your positive energy, and prayers of protection over Carrie and her family. As she continues to do this, we want her to be safe while she does it. And, for anybody who tries to cross her path, to be, absolutely terrified of her, because we can see she is forced to be reckoned with.
And now I wish they can have a hug,
Oh my goodness. You're such a force to be reckoned with. You're such a strong woman. So I'm so grateful that you're on. We'll have to have you on again for sure. But I'm so grateful that I made a friend out of this, and that you're in my life. And this is just amazing. So I really appreciate you coming on. And for everybody listening, we couldn't do this without you. I'll leave Carrie's resources that she recommended, the books and resources for healing. I'll link those below. That way you guys can go purchase them if you want, or go find them. And please share, comment, anything helps us. These topics don't really get elevated in the algorithm, so any help from you guys is awesome. So thank you guys so much. God bless you, and we will see you next week.